Welcome to the Department of Toxic Substances Control workshop on the motor vehicle tires containing 6 PPD priority product proposal. My name is Jessica Anderson, and I am the public participation specialist with the Department of Toxic Substances Control, which we will refer to as DTSC throughout this session. I want to thank you for taking the time to join us today, especially during these challenging times. We sincerely wish you and your families are well and are keeping safe. Workshop is scheduled from 9 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. with a short break at 10:30. The purpose of today's webinar is to present information on why DTSC is considering listing motor vehicle tires containing 6 PPD as a priority product and to hear your feedback. Dr. Ann Cooper-Doherty and I will be facilitating today's meeting. Slide 2, please. We're in a view and listen-only role. Today, we will be taking questions through the Q&A feature, so please click on the Q&A button at the bottom of your toolbar, at the bottom of your screen to send your questions or comments. You may send them at any point throughout the webinar, and we will respond during the Q&A sessions at the end of each presentation. You may send as many questions as you want, however, we request that you send one at a time so we're able to respond to them adequately. We'll do our best to respond to questions in the order that they are received. Any remaining questions will be answered in the Q&A session at the end of this workshop. Please note, we will not be taking questions by chat function. For those joining by phone, please press *9 to raise your hand and let us know you have a question. You'll be called upon and prompted to unmute yourself. We also encourage you to send your questions or comments to Safer Consumer Products at dtsc.ca.gov, and we'll do our best to respond during the Q&A session. Lastly, please know that we're hosting this webinar from different locations, and we request that you bear with us if there's any lag time or other technical issues. We sincerely appreciate your patience, understanding, and cooperation in making this a successful meeting. Slide 3, please. The agenda for today's workshop is broken down into two parts with a short Q&A after each presentation, followed by a public comment and remaining Q&A discussion. So part one will be a general intro from Dr. Meredith Williams, followed by a DTSC presentation from Dr. Ann Cooper-Doherty, and then a presentation from Sarah Ryan of Big Valley Band of Pomo Indians, and the Cal EPA Tribal Advisory Committee, and then a presentation by Ed Kaloje from the University of Washington, Tacoma, Seattle. We'll have a short 10-minute break, and then part two will consist of presentations from the United States Tire Manufacturing Association, Stephanie Blair from Washington State University, and Andrew Patterson from Eurofins Environment Testing America. At the end of that, we'll have a public comment period. We'll have the remaining Q&A discussion, followed by closing comments. We'll now invite Dr. Meredith Williams, the director of DTSC, to give us some opening remarks, followed by Dr. Ann Cooper-Doherty, Senior Environmental Scientist, to begin our presentation. Dr. Williams?
Good morning. Thank you, Jessica, and good morning, everyone. Thank you for taking the time to participate in this workshop and yesterday's workshops, if you happen to have the opportunity to join those. I understand that there was a tremendous amount of good information shared, and I expect today to be no different. Especially want to thank our panelists for joining us and not just for this conversation today, but for being available to us as we research this chemical 6-PPD over the last months and really educating us about a number of aspects of the chemical. You're going to hear a lot today, I imagine, about coho salmon in particular. And this is almost ironic for Safer Consumer Products. We have used the salmon life cycle as a metaphor for the work that we do over the last number of years. This is our deputy director, Carl Palmer, has a way with metaphors, and he really laid out how the life cycle requires that we find our way back to the origin of our work, which is the product selection part of our work, and that we overcome certain obstacles. And it really is an apt metaphor for what we do. It is a marvel that salmon and other anadromous fish manage to do what they do, you know, to go back to the place where they were born and spawn and create that next generation. It's a marvel in and of itself. And right now, it's even more challenging than it ever could be. It could have been imagined, whether that's the rising temperatures in waters, which really work against the success of small fish and their growth, whether it's the fact that the best places to lay eggs are often clogged with sediment that's run off from our landscape, or whether that's, there aren't deep pools that help the fish hide and stay cool when they need to. So, you know, that's a lot of stress on a salmon, on a coho salmon. And when you think about it, that, again, those are enough challenges, but we're now understanding how we're adding additional challenges to their life cycle. And in the case of 6PPD, we have a good understanding of the relationship, that causal relationship between the coho salmon die-offs that are being experienced in the northern parts of the state and further up into the Northwest, the Pacific Northwest. And it's not that common, actually, that association is proven to be so strong. DDT comes to mind. I'm a bird watcher, and I have to confess that when I see a bald eagle, I'm still really pleased, but I no longer think of it as a rare occurrence. And that's because that's one species that recovered based on the actions that we took as a society and as government to eliminate DDT, get it out of the ecosystems, and give those birds a fighting chance to reproduce. So the work that's being done today that you'll hear about today is remarkable work. You'll hear today, I'm really pleased that we have Sarah Ryan from the Big Valley Band of Pomo Indians. She has talked to us in general about how the department, how Cal EPA interacts with tribes. Her wisdom is tremendous, and I've been very fortunate to be able to hear directly from her, and my entire deputy team has had that opportunity also. And I'm very, very grateful to Sarah for joining us today so that you could all have that opportunity to learn about the importance of coho salmon to the tribes and what this means in terms of a very challenging, you know, trying to preserve parts of their lifestyle. And then you'll also hear about what role this chemical plays in the function of a tire and in making it last longer and the duration. And you'll hear a bit about what it takes to make a safe tire. So it's a lot of information to get to today. So I don't want to take too much more time. Again, thank you. I look forward to the outcomes of the discussion today. I'm very pleased with the team. I have to salute everyone who worked on the workshops for the last several days, our public participation staff, and of course the technical staff at Safer Consumer Products for providing this opportunity for us to get even more information about the role of this chemical in tires and what it might mean in terms of harm to ecosystems. So I thank you all. And with that, I'll turn it back to Jessica, unless Jessica, you want me to directly introduce Sarah. Okay.
Oh, me.
Okay. Thank you.
Great. Thanks so much, Meredith, for that great opening. Next slide, please. So I'm Ann Cooper Doherty with the Safer Consumer Products Program. Thanks so much to all of you for joining today. This is the last of our three workshops that we're having this week on chemicals and tires. And as Meredith mentioned, today we are focused on 6PPD. Next slide, please. So first, I wanted to provide a bit of an overview of the Safer Consumer Products Framework. Essentially, SCP regulates consumer products sold in California through a four-step process. In the first step, we've generated a menu of chemicals that comes from a compiled list of chemicals listed as of concern by authoritative bodies. Once we have that menu of chemicals, we move to step two, where we prioritize product chemical combinations that may cause harm to people or the environment. And this involves a great deal of stakeholder engagement like we're doing today. Once we have prioritized and then listed a product chemical combination through rulemaking, it becomes a priority product. At that point, manufacturers of that product chemical combination must notify DTSC and then evaluate safer alternatives using an alternatives analysis. They will submit this report to DTSC and it will be publicly available. And then finally, depending on DTSC's assessment of the AA report, there are a wide range of regulatory responses that DTSC can use as needed to protect public health or the environment. Slide six, please. So a bit more on step two, which is where we are today. The product chemical prioritization process is actually a number of smaller steps, starting from initial screening and public engagement on a topic, which is what we were doing yesterday with the other chemicals work, through proposing a priority product, and finally the initiation of rulemaking. For motor vehicle tires containing 6 PPD, we have proposed a priority product and released our draft product chemical profile. We are currently holding our pre-rulemaking workshop. And after this workshop, the next steps will include scientific peer review and initiation of rulemaking. Slide seven, please. So there's really been a great deal of public interest in this topic, as I'm sure you're all aware, including a recent hearing in the U.S. House's Natural Resources Committee's Subcommittee on Oversight and Investigations. So we are excited to hear more about 6-PPD and 6-PPD quinone today. But first, I wanted to give a really brief overview. Next slide, please. So Washington State has observed mass pre-spawn die-offs of coho salmon for years. This was first documented in the scientific literature by Schultz et al. In 2011, although it was undoubtedly occurring before that. This was discovered during surveys of habitat restoration efforts in the area, and it was eventually dubbed the Urban Runoff Mortality Syndrome, or URMS. These die-offs were correlated with rain events, as well as proximity to roads and impervious surfaces. Next slide, please. Interestingly, the impacts appear to be fairly unique to coho salmon. In the lab, coho died in hours after exposure to Rome stormwater, but not chum. These observed impacts include surface swimming and gaping, sideways or circular swimming, loss of equilibrium, splaying of fins, and eventually death. And we'll see videos to that extent later today. Interestingly, they were not able to reproduce these effects with typical stormwater toxicants like pHs or heavy metals. Next slide, please. So after years of work, which you'll also hear more about today, researchers in Washington discovered the causal agent of URMS to be 6-PPD quinone, and that was published by Tian et al. In the Science paper that I strongly encourage folks to read if you haven't had a chance to yet. Slide 11, please. So to understand 6-PPD quinone, you have to first understand 6-PPD, which is the actual ingredient in tires. 6-PPD is an antidegradant. Specifically, it protects rubber from reactions with ozone or oxygen, which can cause the rubber to crack. In the image in the top right, the rubber on the left contains an antidegradant, and the rubber on the right does not. You can see the cracking in the rubber on the right, which underscores the importance of antidegradants in maintaining the integrity of the tire and the rubber. We know that 6-PPD has been used in tires since the 1950s and the 1960s, and is present at about 1% to 2% by weight. By design, it migrates to the tire surface over the lifetime of the tire, where it then creates a protective film. Next slide, please. So a previously unknown reaction product of 6-PPD and ozone turns out to be 6-PPD quinone. Researchers in Washington synthesized 6-PPD quinone in the lab, and they observed the same toxicity to coho from 6-PPD quinone as they saw from the stormwater and the die-off events. 6-PPD quinone appears to be more environmentally stable than 6-PPD as well. Next slide, please. So the Safer Consumer Products process centers around two key prioritization criteria, which are paraphrased here. The first is the potential for exposure to 6-PPD from motor vehicle tires, and then the potential for significant or widespread adverse impacts from exposure, emphasis on the words potential, of course. So now I want to briefly walk through our determination that motor vehicle tires containing 6-PPD meet these prioritization criteria. Next slide, please. So first, on the potential for exposure to 6-PPD and 6-PPD quinone. 6-PPD is used in presumably all tires, including the estimated over 171 million tires that were driven on California roads in 2020. And there are high rates of release of tire particles to the aquatic environment, as we heard a great deal about yesterday. Additionally, end-of-life applications may further contribute to exposure to 6-PPD and 6-PPD quinone, although this is a big data gap that we'd love to hear more about. And detections of 6-PPD quinone in California runoff and waterways are available. Next slide, please. So moving on to the potential for significant adverse impacts. We know that 6-PPD is toxic at multiple trophic levels, can impair wildlife survival, and is toxic to algae. And then 6-PPD quinone is acutely toxic to coho at a variety of life stages. Environmental detections of 6-PPD quinone in California are above VLC50, as evidenced by the box and whisker plot to the right from the Tian et al. Paper. The plots for roadway runoff from Los Angeles and receiving water from San Francisco are circled. Interestingly, of the sites that where there were detections of 6-PPD quinone in San Francisco, the highest detection was actually a creek whose watershed was 90% open space, but the sampling point was located near a heavily trafficked road. Next slide, please. So exposure to coho is particularly of concern, as coho have been declining rapidly in California since the 1960s, as evidenced by this bar graph from our product chemical draft profile. Slide 17, please. And we're also concerned that these adverse impacts are to an endangered species. The two remaining coho populations in Northern California are either threatened or endangered, as the figure to the right shows. And as Meredith mentioned, coho face a number of additional challenges, including climate change, habitat destruction and loss, exposure to other contaminants, and drought, which can all exacerbate effects from exposure to 6-PPD quinone. Next slide, please. So we've talked a lot about coho, but DTSC is also concerned that 6-PPD quinone may be toxic to other aquatic organisms, especially closely related salmonids, such as the Chinook, golden trout, and steelhead or rainbow trout. This phylogeny from our document illustrates the close relationship between these species. Slide 19, please. So the loss of coho has also adversely impacted human populations. It has significantly impacted California's Native American tribes. The loss of core traditional food sources can be tied to loss of culture, increased physical and mental health issues, poverty. And California's Native American tribes in the state have invested millions of dollars in an effort to retain and replenish coho populations, which is at risk due to the presence of 6-PPD quinone in California's aquatic environments. Slide 20, please. So from that, moving on a bit to about 6-PPD alternatives, the availability of alternatives is unknown at this time, although we certainly welcome more information about that now and as it continues to progress. We will be working to encourage development of alternatives. This will include a potential workshop next spring focused on 6-PPD alternatives. We're also exploring how to use the partner recognition list as outlined in our regulations to help highlight any alternatives as they become available for 6-PPD. Slide 21, please. So given our proposal and available data, we feel that there is enough information to make the case for potential exposure and potential adverse impacts. However, there's certainly many data gaps related to this topic, and DTSC would welcome more information on these topics, including where and under what conditions 6-PPD quinone forms, the environmental fate of 6-PPD and 6-PPD quinone, including other 6-PPD breakdown products, the toxicity of 6-PPD and 6-PPD quinone, including breakdown products, the presence of 6-PPD quinone in the environment, the relative contribution of end-of-life applications, as well as 6-PPD alternatives and data on their safety. A more expansive list of these data requests are available on our CalSafer website. Next slide, please. And on that note, we certainly encourage everyone to go to our CalSafer and our website to review our draft product chemical profile that we released in June and submit comments via CalSafer. That public comment period is open through September 17th. Next slide, please. So I just wanted to touch a little bit on the Safer Consumer process in terms of timing. Our process is a multi-year process, and this is intentionally by design. This is for several reasons. Particularly in this instance, we want to make sure that there are alternatives available to evaluate, given the newness of the discovery. The AA process also requires a life cycle evaluation. This is a deep and broad process that can really take time, but we think is really important to hopefully avoid regrettable substitutions. However, we are looking for ways to expedite the administrative aspects of the process to keep things moving. Next slide, please. So in terms of timing for this particular priority product, possible outline for that includes initiating rulemaking in early 2022, regulations going into effect the second half of 2022 or early 2023, and a preliminary alternatives analysis due in the first half of 2023. Slide 25, please. So there are many aspects of the 6 PPD quinone story that are really important to help mitigate the impacts of this chemical on coho and other aquatic species. These include water monitoring, stormwater treatment, coho surveys to figure out if URMS is occurring in California, as well as other species toxicity testing and fish surveillance of other species that may be impacted. Source control of 6 PPD in the tires, as well as the evaluation of safer alternatives. So all of these are, of course, really, really important to this topic. But this wedge right here, labeled SCP, is the piece that falls under our purview. So while we, of course, want to stay involved in these other aspects and facilitate them to the extent that we can, we'll be focusing our resources on the source control and alternatives piece of this particular story. Slide 26, please. So once again, we encourage you to provide comments through our CalSafer website. The link is here. And if you've got any questions about this work, you can email one of the two email addresses highlighted below. Next slide, please. And with that, we'll take questions.
Hey, Dr. Dougherty.
Okay.
So we'll now be taking some questions regarding DTSC's presentation. If you have a question or comment, please click the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen in the toolbar, and we'll do our best to respond to the questions in the order that we receive them. Again, we won't be using chat function. And for those joining by phone, please press *9 to raise your hand and let us know you have a question. Again, we ask that you only ask one question at a time so we have the opportunity to have all the questions answered. And in addition, you can also email your questions to saferconsumerproducts@dtsc.ca.gov. Okay, so the first question that we have, what are the other uses of 6 PPD in commerce besides tires? Are these also potential sources?
There are a number of other uses of 6 PPD. You'd be actually surprised. Then we go into that a lot more in detail in our draft profile. But as far as our understanding, tires represent the largest use of 6 PPD. And most certainly the largest source of 6 PPD and 6 PPD quinone to the aquatic environment.
Okay, looks like another question that we have is DTSC coordinating with other state agencies and US EPA on this issue?
We are. This is obviously a really big issue that touches a lot of different groups. So we are reaching out in touch with our colleagues at our sister agencies, including the State Water Board, OEHA, and CalRecycle. We've also been coordinating with the US EPA, other states, and tribes to stay abreast of the latest work and research on this topic. And then we also have submitted a proposal to the Interstate Technology and Regulatory Council, or ITRC, to bring together states, tribes, industry, academia, et cetera, to help advance the knowledge and understanding of 6 PPD and 6 PPD quinone, as well as other antidegradants used in tires. So we hope to hear about that proposal soon.
Okay, thank you. It says, what's known about the presence of 6 PPD and 6 PPD quinone in California?
So the data that we have from Tianadel is the what's officially published so far, although I know that there's a lot of work ongoing. San Francisco Estuary Institute is continuing their work on 6 PPD quinone, and we know that there are other efforts ongoing, and we look forward to that data becoming increasingly available over the next few months.
Great. So the next question says, Is it correct that your basis for concern regarding other salmonids is just on the phylogeny analysis and not on the actual data collected in the non-coho species? Are such data being collected to your knowledge?
So the phylogeny is definitely a strong indicator, but stay tuned for the end of towards the end of this workshop. Stephanie Blair will be presenting on some preliminary data on impacts to other salmonids. And additionally, I know that there's a great deal of research going on for other salmonids as well as just other aquatic organisms, period, to try and better understand the toxicity of 6-PPD quinone. It's such a new topic. I think standards weren't even available for the compound until a few months ago. So everyone's kind of started the research at the same time, and we're looking forward to it coming available in the next few months to years.
Thank you. So next question says, California is a major user. Is synthetic turf sports fields with granulated tires? Has anyone looked into 6-PPD in runoff?
So that's a good question. We know that 6-PPD has been detected in some crumb rubber studies. I'm not aware of any detections of 6-PPD quinone quite yet, but my guess is that those may be forthcoming, but we'll certainly want to hear that. And we're looking forward to that information, because that, of course, is a big question about the potential for recycled uses of tires to contribute to the exposure. So that's another big data gap.
Alrighty. And then it says, besides fish, are there any other detrimental environmental effects of 6-PPD and 6-PPD quinone?
Yeah, so we know that there is some aquatic toxicity of 6-PPD itself, but it is really unstable in the environment. So I think it's a little unsure the extent to which that exposure actually occurs. In terms of other detrimental environmental effects of 6-PPD quinone, like I said, we really don't know. It's really tough with this topic because it's just so new that the research is all just starting. So we've heard bits and pieces of it. We even heard some of it yesterday from Andy Booth about some of the work that they're doing. So I think that research will be continuing to come out, but we don't know right now.
Okay. Given the fact significant data gaps exist, do you think initiating rulemaking may be premature?
At this point, we don't. We, of course, would welcome anyone's thoughts that might think otherwise. But I think at this point, the data is pretty strong and our regulations focus on the potential. So we're not necessarily banning anything. What we're doing is evaluating the potential for exposure and potential for adverse impacts, which we think there is. And then based on that, we will ask manufacturers to evaluate alternatives to see if there's a safer option while still, of course, maintaining the safety and integrity of the tire. So we think that evaluation is certainly warranted at this point, given the really strong research that we've seen so far.
Great. So next question says, have mitigation measures like stormwater control measures, e.g. soils and bioinfiltration, been studied for treatment effectiveness of 6-PPD? Does that affect the listing process?
Yeah, so there has been some really great work out of Jen McIntyre's lab, I know, up in Washington, and Stephanie Blair will be also presenting, I think, about that a little bit later in the discussion. But we do know that stormwater control measures like infiltration can reduce the toxicity of stormwater from compounds like 6-PPD quinone. That certainly, I think, will represent interim, you know, treatment of stormwater, particularly given that, you know, while we work to identify safer alternatives. But we think in the long run, the most cost-effective and the just most effective period way to mitigate the impacts of 6-PPD and 6-PPD quinone on coho salmon and other aquatic organisms is source control and evaluating if there are safer alternatives.
Okay. Thank you for that. Next question says, pour in place playground mats used throughout cities, including beaches, are made from used tires. Has anyone looked at these and the sources of 6-PPD and other toxicants?
Like I said, there's some research on the presence of 6-PPD and things like crumb rubber and stuff, but 6-PPD quinone has not been, at least that I've seen in the published yet, but undoubtedly that research is ongoing.
Okay. And has URMS been confirmed in California?
It has not in this time, not officially, although we can imagine that it has probably occurred given the fact that 6-PPD quinone is in the environment in California, and we have still some coho left. Additionally, the die-off of coho salmon in the San Francisco area happened in about the 70s and 80s. And now there are no more coho in the San Francisco area, but we are unsure about the extent to which 6-PPD quinone may or may not have played a role in that die-off. So unfortunately, we're not sure.
Okay, next question says, is there any data on concentrations of 6-PPD or 6-PPD quinone in soils and sediment, specifically in stormwater conveyor systems?
I said some of these questions, you'll stay tuned because we've got the real experts coming up next. I'm just kind of conveying the information that we've gleaned from all their great work. So I think as far as I know, officially published in the scientific literature, I haven't seen any soil or sediment data for 6-PPD quinone, although there is, I think there's road dust data on 6-PPD, particularly out of Europe. But beyond that, I'm not aware of any, but, stay tuned for today and, feel free to ask our other presenters the same questions.
And it says, is 6-PPD quinone safe for humans?
That's unknown at this time as well. I'm not aware of any research on the safety of 6-PPD quinone, in humans.
Okay. I'm going to allow a couple more moments to have any more questions. Okay, so the next one says, how does 6-PPD migrate through tires?
I think that's a great question. Like I said, the USCMA, who's speaking in a few minutes, will probably be able to answer that much better than me. But as far as I understand, it's a function of the physical chemical properties of 6-PPD itself. So I think we'll look more forward to hearing more about that in a little bit.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Doherty. So this concludes our Q&A session on DTSC's presentation. I'll now invite Dr. Williams to introduce Ms. Sarah Ryan from the Big Valley Band of Pomo Indians and the Cal EPA Advisory Committee, excuse me. Dr. Williams?
Thank you, Jessica. And thank you, Ann Cooper, for setting us up for a great conversation today. You already heard my appreciation for Sarah Ryan and for the work that she has volunteered to do with Cal EPA, with DTSC, and with our Safer Consumer Products Program. We're tremendously grateful for that. Sarah Ryan is the Environmental Director, as well as the Emergency Management Director for the Big Valley Band of Pomo Indians. I would be remiss if I didn't acknowledge the tribes on whose land I am participating from today, and that would be the Miwok Wali and the Nisenan tribes. And I think it's important for us to take that moment to recognize that, you know, this landscape hasn't always looked the way that it does now. And the loss of coho along the coast is a tremendous reminder of that. Sarah Ryan is a thoughtful leader who has deepened the engagement of the tribes throughout Cal EPA and throughout the state, and has is a fierce advocate for her tribe, and at the same time, a very solutions-oriented partner for us. And with that in mind, I will turn it over to her with, again, my thanks for her participation today. Thanks, Sarah.
Thank you so much, Meredith. Really glad to be here. I have some slides, so hopefully they can be pulled up. Thank you. Thank you so much, Meredith, for the introduction, and really pleased to be here. I am amazed, actually, at how fast DTSC and the state is moving on this issue, considering that the information is relatively new for California. So kudos for taking this seriously and moving on this. I wanted to provide some context about tribes, and I'll be speaking a little bit about 6-PPD, but I thought it would be useful for the participants of this workshop to hear about how tribes in general are orienting themselves when it comes to contaminants in the environment, and how they, through water monitoring programs and biota monitoring programs, are involved in setting standards and communicating concerns and risks to state agencies. So just a few, you know, I have a few slides on that to provide some context, and I hope that it's helpful for folks. So next slide. In California, there are 109 federally recognized tribes in 34 counties. There's still a lot more tribes that have not been federally recognized that are petitioning for that federal recognition. The state of California does communicate and consult with all, as they define California, Native American tribes. So for those of you who are working throughout the state on this program and other programs having to do with contaminants, you might not have heard of the tribes in your area, but just as Meredith mentioned just a moment ago, it's really good to find out which tribes are in your area. They might not have an office. They might not have any signs, but that are very visible, but they tribes are all over, and they've certainly walked this land for millennia. And some tribes are landless because of policies, and so they're not going to have a rancheria or a reservation, but they are still present and act as a community, are together as a community, and also a government. Next slide, please. If you look at a map of California pre-contact, tribes were in all areas of the state. And so there are these maps that you can see where groups and their kind of language groups oriented, as well as practices and activities oriented. The tribe I work for, Big Valley Band of Pomo Indians, is in the Pomo area that is between Sacramento and the coast, above San Francisco and all the way up into Mendocino County and further. So please keep this in mind, because the tribes of these areas, or tribes are throughout the state to this day. Next slide, please. So tribes also have water monitoring programs. I want to point out that there are 56 tribes in California that have water quality monitoring data in the federal database for water quality. These can be found in the National Water Quality Portal. All the state's water data goes into the National Water Quality Portal eventually. So it's not only our tribes out there as governments and as people taking care of their people, but they are also engaged in identifying contaminants and protecting their resources through these monitoring programs. Tribes do go after funding that's either competitive or non-competitive through EPA, the Bureau of Indian Affairs, the Bureau of Reclamation, other entities, including the state of California, to do their programs. And when you have a water monitoring program, in case you're not familiar with it, you do have to have a quality assurance plan. And for tribes, those have to be federally approved quality assurance plans if this is data that's being funded by US EPA. And you, tribes are also assessing their water based for impairments based on their uses. Next step, please, or next slide. In these funded programs, as I mentioned, there are impairment evaluations, there are specific water quality standard evaluations, and these are the same things that states and regions have to do. This is important when thinking about these emerging contaminants, because we can move forward with analysis and developing monitoring programs to identify what's happening to these resources that the tribes use. And tribes also, it's important to note, are very specific in their time and place for their uses of land and of water. And it's just like, you know, if you're going to celebrate Thanksgiving or something, you're not going to do it in January in some other spot. You're going to do it with your family in November, type of thing. In the same way,
You're muted, Sarah.
Oh, I'm muted. Okay. So did I just get muted for that one slide? I'm sorry.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. So as I was saying, tribes are site-specific in their uses of water and land. It just like for Thanksgiving, people don't celebrate Thanksgiving in June. They're celebrating it usually in, you know, November with their families in certain locations. Same with tribal uses of land and water and of fish and all other animals are doing it at certain times and places, how they were taught and in the ways that they were taught. So this is, you know, when you think about, are there options for tribes, you know, maybe they won't eat coho salmon, maybe they can do another salmon or another fish that is just another fish. It's like, no, if there are certain ceremonies and certain practices that are that have been taught, passed down, that's how they do it. Just like everybody has their own way of doing, you know, following family footsteps. So tribal uses are important to consider when there are when protecting resources. Next slide, please. So again, tribal water data does exist in not only in local databases, but state databases and federal databases as depending on when they're doing how they do their monitoring. And this is data that is to protect their resources. So they are considering the impacts of a contaminant on the fish that they're consuming, or the impacts of the contaminant on the water where they're conducting their resource or conducting their ceremonies. And again, this is information that is available not only through checking databases, but also in communicating with the tribes that are local, that use these waterways, that are using these resources in the areas that you're considering. Next slide, please. So in that sense, tribes can be water quality data partners because they're out there looking at areas, like for example, at Big Valley, we're on the shores of Clear Lake, the largest natural lake in California. We are thinking about when ceremonies are happening and what's happening with the water quality when ceremonies are happening. We have a cyanotoxin monitoring program. So the areas where tribes are gathering tules and other things for the dance, we want to make sure that what's happening in the water there is not going to be impacting our members. And so we're testing for E. coli, we're testing for cyanotoxins in the dance areas because and the gathering areas, because these are, you know, protecting the uses and resources of the tribes. It doesn't mean that, you know, and once we have that data, then we get more engaged in working with the agencies and communicating what we're finding. And often in a water body and for certain resources, it's often just the tribes or mostly the tribes who are collecting that information. Next slide, please. In terms of how that fits into actual standards for the state, you can look at these tribal uses in terms of tribal beneficial uses. If you're aware of basin plans that have water quality standards and you're aware of how permits are written for cleanups and emissions and things like that, it's all based on what are the uses of those areas. So tribal beneficial uses that have to do with cultural use and subsistence consumption are now being integrated into the regional basin plans with the water boards. So in that sense, the impacts of emerging contaminants and the things that you're paying attention to are now going to have this extra layer of, you know, there are these uses that are condoned, you know, that are protected. And those need to be integrated into everybody's thinking in terms of making sure that tribes are not impacted by these contaminants. Next slide, please. I wanted to just show a graphic of, this was originally created for harmful algal blooms, but as you can see in the center, any contaminant is should also be considered in this type of impact pathway of when tribal peoples are engaging in traditional activities. So there are ingestion of water and inhalation of aerosols and dermal exposure, and also just in the ingestion of plants or animals, there are all these different activities that tribes are engaged in when they are living, you know, the traditional life ways of a tribe. And, you know, even in urban areas, there are things that we don't necessarily see that are happening, but tribes are very much engaged throughout the state in gathering their medicines and doing prayers on in waterways, or when they're taking a certain plant. And there's that interaction with the use of them, with the ingestion of them, with teaching the children through these practices. And it's something to consider that, you know, there's this wide range of exposure pathways when it comes to tribal traditional activities that might not look like what other communities are doing when it comes to engaging with the natural world. Next slide, please. And this is something that even with this is a cyanotoxin chart, but this is an example of how over at Big Valley we did a fish study to look at microcystin, which is a liver toxin, in the fish tissue and also livers of various fish. And so we identified the fish species in Clear Lake that we wanted to look at. And, you know, had a, and this is actually from a Cali PA environmental justice grant, measured the, dissected the fish, took the livers and took fish tissue and sent it off to the lab for analysis, and then developed a chart of which fish had the, and shellfish had the highest levels. So we were able to communicate that to the not only to Big Valley, to the Big Valley community, but also to the other tribes who come to Clear Lake for fish consumption ceremonies and other activities. And so just to kind of put a underline on, this is tribal data that was from a project that we felt was necessary. It wasn't something that the county or the state was doing in terms of just measuring the impacts of a contaminant in a food source, but you know, that it was also to protect these fish and to know what's happening and to put an emphasis on the need for removing the impairment on Clear Lake that was causing these issues. Next slide, please. So in terms of 6 PPD and other emerging contaminants, when we think of tribal uses of the land and the water and the natural resources of this state, we are thinking about the impacts on fish availability. Now, coho salmon is not something that runs in, you know, in Lake County, but it's certainly a fish that that the people here are consuming through trade from the tribes up north. And if you go on to various Facebook pages and all sorts of other communication tools, there's a lot of communication between the tribes who have a resource and tribes who have other resources. And there's trade going on, and there's, you know, there's involvement and, hey, come on up and let's go fishing. And so coho is something that and salmon in general are fish that are eaten throughout the state of California. And when you have a contaminant that is reducing those numbers, that is impacting tribal traditional uses of various tribes. So, and there's also the concern about what that means health-wise. What does it mean in terms of water quality impacts? Are there other issues that are happening because of that contaminant in there? And are there other species that are being impacted? And I really like the questions that came up from Anne's presentation. I was going to ask some of the same ones in terms of stormwater. These are the types of things that we're thinking about in terms of this emerging contaminant and how we need to be keeping an eye out and adding that to our own water monitoring programs. Next slide, please. So just a plug again, collaborate with the tribes of your area. Know which tribes are in your area. And there are lists that the Cal EPA has and the Native American Heritage Commission has about what tribes are in your area. You can also just Google it. But know that tribes are going to be protecting their people and their resources. And so that means that tribes do want to be engaged in conversations about contaminants that have those impacts. And they often have water monitoring programs and biota monitoring programs where they will be able to assist with data accumulation on the matter. So keep that in mind. And you know, and this information and that collaboration will enhance the programs that we all have. We want to get to the end result of this, which is what do we need to do to prevent any loss of fish life and contamination of the natural resources because of 6 PPD. It is ubiquitous. So, you know, tires are at least, and, you know, we need to get to the bottom of what kind of impact is actually happening on the environment and potentially on the people. So being involved with tribes is a great way to have an enhancement of that program. And I believe the last slide is just my contact info. Yeah, so these are Tulies that are on the shores of Clear Lake and our annual Tule Boat Festival. Some of the Tulies have fluoridone in them, which is an herbicide that's being used by the California Department of Food and Ag to manage hydrilla, an invasive aquatic weed on Clear Lake. And so that does affect the consumption of Tulies for the tribes, and it also affects the availability of Tulies. And so just know that, you know, impacts are all around us in terms of how Native peoples are engaging with the resources of the land and waters, and we should be doing our best to make sure that there's not an impairment for tribal traditional uses, because those are rights, you know, of the tribes, and they are important. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Ryan. Next slide, please. Okay, so we'll now be taking some questions regarding Ms. Ryan's presentation. If you have any questions or comments, please click the Q&A button and enter your question or comment. You can also email it to saferconsumerproducts@dtsc.ca.gov or press *9 to raise your hand if you're joining by phone. Okay, so it looks like our first question says, we heard from Washington tribes about their treaty rights and fish. Does this apply to California tribes as well?
The treaties are a complicated thing in California. Many tribes there were treaties that were developed for many tribes in California. However, very few of them were actually ratified by the federal government. So in terms of, you know, it really is a case-by-case basis, but I know that what Big Valley Band of Pomo Indians is using is not only the water rights of you know, senior water rights, but also some inherent rights that some of the courts have identified in terms of not needing fishing licenses and things like that. So I think in California, it's a little bit more complex. And it really is a tribe by tribe basis. And that's one of the reasons why tribes are using tribal beneficial uses and water quality standards through, you know, existing state frameworks to protect resources.
Okay, thank you for that. Next question says, we often see historic coho habitat range, coho habitat range on a map to have a defined footprint. Can you explain how coho may have been impacted or have been part of the culture to the tribes beyond this footprint?
Well, as I mentioned earlier, there's a lot of trade going on with tribes. I see it on a daily basis on some pages that I'm on Facebook. but there are, you know, between families and between natural alliances of tribes, there is coho being and salmon in general being passed around the state. As well as other fish, but salmon in particular. So yes, just because a boundary is there on some map that says these are the tribes of that area, please remember to look way beyond that to traditional trade that has happened in the past and even is occurring today. Like, for example, Big Valley, we're 2.5 hours from the coast. However, there is a trail that historic trail that our members use to get to the coast to not only get seaweed but also do trade of some of the items that are here for the tribes that are on the coast. So in general, tribes would when they entered an area that was belonged to another tribe, they would always ask permission. That's still going on today. But that sort of communication from a traditional level of permission to enter and also to trade and have relationships with the other tribes is still very much present today and is actually growing. So that means that even though tribes, coho salmon of a certain area would, and the loss of them is definitely impacting the tribes of that area, but are also impacting tribes that have trade to this day with those tribes.
Okay, great. So it says, what are the Big Valley Pomo tribal traditional uses for the coho salmon?
The Big Valley tribe, so because we're 2.5 hours from the coast, it is mostly a consumption that would be happening during trade times. So in terms of other, the tribe eats other local fish much more. Of course, some of these fish are on the state endangered species list. There's very few of them left. But in terms of Big Valleys, it is really just consumption that happens during trade.
Great. Next question says, can emerging contaminants such as 6-PPD easily be added to tribal monitoring programs?
Great question. If we were using US EPA funds, we would need to add it to our quality assurance plans. And so that would require identifying the labs that would be analyzing for the 6-PPD decision. So identifying their source method and also linking it to existing standards. Now, since there, I'm not sure if there are standards for 6-PPD. It sounds like in California there aren't yet. I don't think there's federal standards. So we would basically be saying, there is a preliminary identification of X amount that is safe to consume or safe levels in fish, and those, and then also include the way that it would be monitored. So we have to identify those items and update our quality assurance plans, send those over to US EPA and get their feedback and make any changes that they consider. So yes, we have done that for cyanotoxins at Big Valley, and tribes are measuring other contaminants in their in land, water, and air. And sometimes it's new stuff. So as long, if it is funded by EPA, those types of things can be added through a quality assurance plan. And, then the tribes would need to find or be able to get additional funds to pay for the analysis and the staff time to go sample. But this has been done before on other contaminants as well. So it's doable. There's a pathway.
Thank you for that. Okay, so this will be our last question. It says, do you know how many tribes in California have treatment as state status for setting water quality standards? Have any set standards for emerging contaminants?
That's a good question. I think, the water quality standards, so I don't think it's that many tribes. I think it's under 25 tribes that have treatment as a state for water quality standards. But consider this. Water quality standards for tribes have to be done on waters that are adjacent to trust lands. That means that it's been taken into trust by the U.S. government, which is a process. Beneficial uses, tribal beneficial uses, can be on any waters that are within the tribe's ancestral lands. You don't have to have trust land to develop tribal beneficial uses. So a lot of tribes are now moving toward the development of tribal beneficial uses that are based on the impacts and impairments to their uses. That's what we're doing at Big Valley. To have tribal water quality standards, that will kick out any tribes that are landless and don't have trust lands. And it is very much limited to the small area that is adjacent to the trust land. So tribal beneficial uses is a much better way to go, in my opinion, because it has water quality standards. And it has, and can be on waters that are impacting tribal uses, where as long as it's within their ancestral lands.
Thank you so much, Ms. Ryan. Okay, so that concludes our question and answer session on Ms. Ryan's presentation. We'll now invite Dr. Edward Kaloje from the University of Washington, Tacoma, Seattle, to present.
Hi, and thank you for the opportunity to present here. I am getting my slides up now. Okay, does everybody see that?
Yes.
Again, I'm Ed Kaloje. I work up at the University of Washington in Tacoma in Seattle. Most of my research group is located at the Center for Urban Waters here in Tacoma. And the first thing I'd like to do is just acknowledge my many co-authors on this publication. I really represent a larger village of people who've been working on this issue of coho salmon and stormwater for over 20 years now. And that includes people like Jen McIntyre and Nat Schultz at NOAA National Marine Fisheries Service, Jay Davis at U.S. Fish and Wildlife, and the many people in the various labs that contributed to this data. So we've already heard a little bit today and yesterday about the urban runoff mortality syndrome. I'm not really going to go through this, other than to add a couple key observations. This was really something that was started to be observed in the Seattle area in the 1990s when urban habitat restoration started to bring in species that hadn't previously been there recently because the physical habitat quality was not good enough. And this really spawned these observations of where it really took individual people out there watching individual salmon and tracking them day after day to recognize that something happened when it rained to coho salmon. And so that's really been a theme of this, about even though these fish were dying, it's not necessarily easy to see this in progress, especially because coho salmon don't have swim bladders. They don't float up to the top of the water when they die. They sink down to the bottom, and that just makes things trickier. Also, coho salmon are certainly seem to be the most sensitive species in this system. There's no concurrent mortality in cutthroat trout and chum salmon during the same rain events that kill coho salmon. I would also like to add that over the last year, I've started to hear observations come out of British Columbia of coho salmon and stormwater. In particular, there were a number of observations this spring where juvenile coho salmon seemed to be dying after rainstorms in the Vancouver, British Columbia area. So I do expect to hear more documentation of phenomena like this across the border in the coming months and years. So what have we done here at the Center for Urban Waters? I was lucky enough to join this team in 2014, 2015 to try and better understand water quality during coho mortality events. And to do this, we've really been using this technique of high-resolution mass spectrometry. And this is really a technique that's based on a holistic analysis of contaminants in water. So you're not telling the instrument to look for specific chemicals like PAHs or DDT or perfluorinated compounds. You're kind of trying to let it detect everything, and then you sort through that data and try to figure out what's there. So because this is considered to be a more unbiased analytical approach with fewer assumptions, it's good at these questions that are open-ended, like what's killing these fish. So really what we've tried to do here at the Center for Urban Waters is to couple together our high-resolution mass spectrometry along with the toxicology exposures that Jen McIntyre and NOAA are doing in an effects-directed analysis framework. So that's basically the conceptual basis of these studies. So some key observations. Right around 2017, Jen McIntyre's toxicology group was figuring out that of all the vehicle-related chemical sources they looked at, only tire leachates were capable of killing coho salmon. So she did some screening studies with juveniles. And here, in the fall of 2017, when the Coho and Chum returned to the Suquamish tribal hatchery over on the Kitsap Peninsula, she did some concurrent exposures of Coho and Chum salmon adults to tire leachate. And what Jen did in this study was these blue tubes here you see on the left, they're actually filled with a mixture of tire particles, tire tread particles from a 9-tire mixture we used. And then Jen circulated groundwater through these blue tubes for 24 hours and made, I think, 1,700 liters of tire leachate in this big stainless steel tank. And then exposed that to both Coho and Chum salmon at the same time. So that's what you see in these plastic tubes. There's an adult salmon in those. And the control there, the negative control, was the well water that hadn't been put through that leaching system. And the key observation of those studies, which were actually repeated four times that fall for 64 adult fish, were that all of the Chum salmon in the control survived. All of the Coho salmon in the control, excepting one, survived. The only Coho salmon that died in the control got spun around in the tube and was backwards, so their gills were no longer aerated correctly. All of the adult Chum salmon survived the tire leachate exposure, and all of the adult Coho salmon died from the tire leachate exposure. So this was really key evidence for us that not only the tire leachate we were making, which is roughly as strong as what you expect to see coming off a busy multi-lane highway, there was something going on there. It was killing not only juvenile Coho salmon, but adult Coho salmon. And so we knew something was problematic in that tire leachate mixture, which was extremely chemically complex. And so what we've spent, we spent basically the next 2.5 years trying to figure out what that was. And again, we used this TIE, a toxicity identification and evaluation, or EDA, an effects-directed analysis approach, where we're basically manipulating water quality to selectively remove some constituents and leave others behind and try and understand the toxicological response from that. So the analogy I've been using, one that was developed by Kathy Peter here, let's say you had some purple Kool-Aid that was toxic to fish. You pass it through a column that removes the red dye molecules and lets the blue ones go through. If you expose that effluent from the column to something like juvenile Coho salmon for a day, you could try and say, like, do those fish die or do they survive? If they die, that tells you to look at the blue dye molecules. There's something problematic there. If they survive, that tells you to look at the red dye molecules. Something was trapped on the column that removed the toxicity. So we essentially used that same approach to try and figure out what it was in tire leachate that Coho salmon were sensitive to with respect to acute toxicity. And that process looks like this. And I always like to start this slide by talking about our positive and negative controls. Our negative controls were combinations of either solvents, you know, all the solvents we use this, or exposure water blanks, like we'd put just DI water through the whole system. I think there were 25 exposures there for 125 Coho, and not a single one died in the negative control. Our positive control was a tire tread leachate we made from a mixture of new and used tires. We did 27 exposures there to 135 Coho. I think only 2 Coho salmon survived that. And that's over a period of, you know, 2 to 3 years. And so this is just incredibly key data that if you put tire leachate together with Coho salmon, they die very rapidly and with the same types of symptoms that are seen out in the field for the adults. With respect to the separation, our high-resolution mass spectrometry instrument says that the tire leachate we're exposed to is extremely chemically complex. It has over 2,000 chemicals present. And then from there, we started to fractionate it. We put it through cation exchange and an XAD resin. The toxic fraction there is in the middle. That has about 1,300 chemical detections on our instrument. We next went to a silica gel column and did normal phase chromatography. The second fraction there was toxic. That had about 650 chemicals to it. We then started putting these through HPLC columns with different packings. The C18 packing here, the 10 to 11 minute fraction there was toxic to coho salmon. That had 225 chemicals in it. We then took that sample, we fractionated it on a PFP column. The 10 to 11 minute fraction again there was toxic. That had 26 chemicals to it. And then finally, we did one more fractionation with a phenyl packing, and the 8 to 9 minute fraction there was toxic. And that only had 4 chemicals that we could detect on our instrument. And that was still killing the coho salmon. So this process here helps you prioritize this complex chemical mixture. It tells you what chemicals to look at the most, right? So we had this really purified fraction that was still killing coho salmon. You know, we dried it down. It makes this like reddish precipitate. That's what you see in the test tube there. So now our job was to figure out what exactly that was. And the compound that was lighting up our instrument in that final toxic fraction had a chemical formula of C18H22N2O2. And we just couldn't find that in the environmental literature. It wasn't something people were paying attention to. We did some work, you know, we assumed it was a transformation product, and we started looking for just like close chemical formulas. And that's really what led us to 6 ppb in the EPA crumb rubber report that was published in 2019, which had a very similar chemical formula to this compound we're looking at. And so we did some more digging, and we finally found this paper from Latimer 1983 that reported a C18H22N2O2 ozonation product of 6 ppb. And so from this point on, we really started to pay attention to what's happening to 6 ppb when it reacts with ozone, because it seems to make the same exact chemical formula that we're looking at in this toxic fraction that the coho were so sensitive to. So we got some industrial grade 6 ppb, we ozonated it using a gas phase ozonation. You can see that dark layer on top. That's where the 6 ppb has reacted with the ozone and created this complex mixture of transformation products. We purified that. We found out that the C18H22N2O2 in the tire leachate and the C18H22N2O2 from the ozonation had the exact same retention time on our chromatogram. Their mass spectra exactly matched, saying that that was the same compound, right? Not just by retention time, but also by mass spectra. And finally, Andre Simpson up at the University of Toronto did an NMR analysis to give us the structure. And that's where, you know, Andre basically located the oxygens on the molecule to say that this was actually a 6 ppb quinone molecule, which you've been, you know, hearing about a lot this year. So now we basically had a match on the chromatography, the mass spectrum, and we knew what it was. So one thing Ann Cooper asked me to talk about a little bit today was the fate, you know, and how this 6 ppb quinone behaves in the environment. I just want to make a couple chemical observations while we have the molecular structure up here. You can see that the 6 ppb quinone has some oxygen added to it relative to the 6 ppb. The addition of the oxygen typically tells us that you can expect that compound to be more mobile in the environment. It's more easily transportable because less of it will be stuck to things like sediments and solids and organic matter. We also know that the 6 ppb is more stable than, the 6 ppb quinone is more stable than 6 ppb because it doesn't seem to experience the same hydrolysis that 6 ppb does. 6 ppb actually degrades relatively quickly in water by just hydrolyzing. It's reacting with water. 6 ppb quinone doesn't seem to have that same pH-dependent hydrolysis reaction happen. So its lifetime in water is longer than 6 ppb and it's more stable, which allows it to move further, to transport further, and potentially to be harder to degrade. It's also not ionized the same way that 6 ppb is. At environmental pHs, some 6 ppb is neutral and some 6 ppb is protonated with a positive charge. Pretty much at all pH values, 6 ppb quinone is a neutral molecule, which also gives it different transport and even bioavailability behaviors. So these are some of the things we know so far. Finally, one last observation. We're dealing with a quinone here. quinones have really interesting redox chemistry. This is probably some of the root of why they can be highly toxic compounds. They can cycle between the quinone, the semiquinone, and the hydroquinone, which really gives them some complex chemistry. And I think a lot of that quinone redox chemistry is going to be both environmentally and analytically important. And that definitely represents a current data gap for us. So what did we do once we made this 6-BPD quinone? We exposed it to fish here. Just some comparison with the parent 6-BPD compound. When we gave the parent 6-BPD compound to juvenile coho salmon at 450 micrograms per liter, after 24 hours, we saw one dead and one symptomatic fish. At 30 micrograms per liter, none of the juvenile coho salmon were dead after 24 hours. Meanwhile, if we took just the ozonation mixture that was unpurified, it contained 6-BPD quinone and a bunch of other transformation products, that killed all of the coho salmon in 24 hours. And in fact, all of them died within 5 or 6 hours. If we then purified the 6-BPD quinone out of that ozonation mixture, that was getting the coho salmon sick in 90 minutes, and they were all dead in about 4 to 5 hours, right? And so this is just a clear indication to us that this transformation product can be more toxic than the parent chemicals. So we went and did controlled exposures, and we found, you know, on the bottom here, this is controlled exposures to just the 6-BPD quinone that we purified from the ozonation mixture in our own lab. And we got an LC50 value of about 0.8 micrograms per liter. That almost exactly matched the LC50 curve we got from dilutions of multi-lane roadway runoff and tire rubber leachate. Both of these were systems that Jen McIntyre knew were toxic to coho salmon. And because you didn't really need anything else in those complex mixtures to explain the toxicity other than 6-BPD quinone, this is why we called it the primary causal toxicant. We're not excluding the possibility of other toxicants that are present there that might modulate or moderate the response, but we think the 6-BPD quinone is responsible for the majority of the toxicity we see in coho salmon. And finally, this also makes a lot of sense. We can expect that anywhere that 6-BPD is used and exposed to the atmosphere, that trace level of atmospheric ozone is going to create 6-BPD quinone, right? This EU report from 2005 says that the predominant sink of 6-BPD is the reaction with ozone, which is the chemical basis of the anti-cracking effect of 6-BPD. This also includes recycled materials. You know, we've looked at some crumb rubbers in the last year, and we definitely see 6-BPD quinone present in leachates from recycled materials. Not just crumb rubbers on fields, but other materials like building materials that use recycled tires. So probably as long as there's residual 6-BPD around, we can expect quinone formation. And finally, a slide here about environmental relevance. I think Ann Cooper already showed this. We're detecting concentrations of 6-BPD quinone above the LC50 value we found in the multi-lane roadway runoff. Out in the receiving waters, we're near or above the LC50 value. Now, late in March, commercial standards of 6-BPD quinone became available. And so late in March, we got a standard of 6-BPD quinone from HPC. And we immediately observed that that commercial standard had a much higher peak area response relative to the 6-BPD quinone that we purified from that mixture. And that basically told us that we had a lot less 6-BPD quinone in our stock solutions than we thought. So we've repeated a bunch of these studies over the last year. And what I can say about that is this. There was actually less 6-BPD quinone in all of these samples, including the LC50 exposures, than we expected. So all these relative comparisons are still good. This plot still holds up. However, I think we can expect, and we'll be publishing on this later this year, that the y-axis here is probably about an order of magnitude too high. We can expect lower environmental concentrations and a lower LC50 for 6-BPD quinone. We're still in the process of finalizing our data, but I think our current LC50 for 6-BPD quinone using the HPC standard, again, you know, we're doing exposures to fish with the commercially available standard. We currently think the LC50 is somewhere around 100 nanograms per liter, so substantially lower. So it's actually even more toxic than we originally reported. So that's what I think we can expect to see as we look out in the environment and do some of these comparisons to the LC50. I expect to be publishing that data in the fall. And finally, really quickly, our last piece of evidence. I just have one more slide after this one. It's not just the chemistry that makes sense. The visual observations also match as well. Here's a video of field mortality of adult coho salmon in the field after it rains. This is happening in the lower Duwamish River. You can see that adult coho is up on its side. It's swimming in circles. It's kind of gaping for air, right? This is very characteristic symptomology of the exposure. Here's what it looks like when we give juvenile coho purified 6-BPD quinone. They're coming up to the top, they're gaping for air, they're up on the side, they're doing that exact same, you know, spiraling type observation. And so it wasn't just the chemistry that was making sense to us, the visual observations were also telling us that the timescales and behaviors that are associated with this mortality were also matching when we exposed juvenile coho to the 6-BPD quinone. So a couple summary points here. It's really clear to us that tire rubber residuals are complex mixtures of emerging organic contaminants and water quality impairment. Coho salmon specifically, and potentially other ones, are highly sensitive to these mixtures. When it comes to 6-BPD, it's a compound that was both known to be toxic and it's designed to react. With those two properties together, we really shouldn't be surprised when products of toxic compounds are themselves toxic. This is something that the pesticide industry has known for many decades. They carefully look at transformation products of toxic compounds. And I think that same mindset is also something we should bring to compounds like 6-BPD that both have these characteristics of toxicity and design reactivity. For California, I would say coho salmon definitely tell us to pay special attention when busy roads intersect sensitive habitats. And finally, I think that habitat restoration efforts include not just physical habitat, but also chemical habitat. And I think sensitive species restoration will likely teach us new things about chemical habitat quality and needs. So that might be something to anticipate down the road. And finally, you know, I'd like us to think about, you know, how we can get to something like a salmon safe tire, which is safe, not just for people, but also for the environment and the ecosystem. That to me seems like a really nice direction to go in around this issue. I'd like to thank my team, in particular, Zhenyu Tian, you know, did the so much hard work on this. We all owe him a huge debt of gratitude. Kathy Peter really built the foundation for this. Our many sponsors and collaborators who are all like really consequential in helping us. You know, 10 seconds for a plug for the MCON 2021 conference that I'm hosting in mid-September this year. We expect to have lots of content on roadway runoff, microplastics, PFAS, and other emerging contaminants like 6-BPD. So you might take a quick look at MCON 2021. I should be posting the technical agenda pretty soon. You might find that interesting as a place to learn more about this set of compounds. And that's all I have for you today.
Thank you, Dr. Kaloje. Okay, so we'll now be taking some questions regarding Dr. Kaloje's presentation. So if you have any questions or comments, please click on the Q&A button at the bottom, star 9 by phone or email Safer Consumer Products. Once again, please ask one question at a time. We have... Okay, so it says, the first question says, how did you purify 6-BPD quinone from the mixture and did that have an effect on enhancing formation of 6-BPDQ?
Yeah, so we purified 6-BPD quinone from the from the ozonation mixture using the same set of steps that we use for the effects direct analysis. So I think we use cation exchange followed by silica gel followed by the prep scale HPLC column separations. And then we accumulated mass. We're still trying to understand exactly where we lost mass. We think it's likely that some oxidative polymerization happened at the end when we dried it. You know, there's all these reports of the antioxidants on tires making a film on the surface of the tire that creates that barrier. We're sort of suspecting that we might have made some of that same film in our 6 ppd quinone as we dried it down at the end. We're trying to collect data to better understand that, but we think we had a solid drop out of solution at the end. I think we just have some data gaps around quinone chemistry in the environment and where it's stable and where it's unstable. So that's how we purified it. I don't think it enhanced the toxicity. I think we just removed, you know, other constituents along the line. And in particular, when we got the HPC standard, I think our first preliminary exposure, we put in 1 microgram per liter of the HPC standard, and the coho salmon were sick in like 40 to 45 minutes. And we had just never seen that before. That was incredibly fast. So if anything, you know, our purified 6 ppd quinone wasn't killing things as quickly as the HPC one, although we do think that's because of just less was present there. So I hope that answers that question.
Yes, we have one final question that says, would you expect quinones formed from other PPDs to also be toxic in salmon?
Yeah, so that's a good question. We do not have data on that at the current time. Based on typical structure activity relationships that relate chemical structures to toxicity, I would think that most chemists and toxicologists would expect some toxicity from other related quinones, although the degree of that toxicity probably goes up and down depending on the exact structure you have. So I think that's an open question and a data gap. I think that answers that.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kaloje. So that concludes our Q&A for this presentation. We will now be taking a short break. If you can put the slides back up, we should return at 10:35.
My name is Sarah Amick. I'm USTMA's Vice President for Environment, Health, Safety, and Sustainability and Senior Counsel for the U.S. Tire Manufacturers Association. We want to thank DTSC for the opportunity to present today and welcome the opportunity for continued dialogue with all of the stakeholders on the phone today. We can go to the next slide. So I'm joined today by two colleagues, Howard Colvin, who's an independent technical consultant and also a polymer expert to the U.S. Tire Manufacturers Association, and also Julie Pinko, who's a principal scientist with TOC Strategies and also a consultant to USTMA as well. Next slide. So just a little bit about who USTMA is. Again, we're a Washington, D.C.-based trade association. We represent 13 tire manufacturers that manufacture tires in the United States. Our members are committed to sustainable practices in every aspect of their businesses, and together they embrace a shared responsibility of helping to achieve a more sustainable society. Our members work to engineer innovations that reduce CO2 emissions, enhance tire safety and performance, driving progress in workplace safety, preserving the environment throughout a tire's life cycle. And we're continuously looking for ways to improve our societal contributions of the products and operations that our members have. Next slide. So just an overview of what we'll cover today. We've talked a lot about this morning 6 ppd and 6 ppd quinone, but I thought it might be helpful to just provide some more information about the fact that these are two distinct materials. We'll review some of the relevant data gaps. We've heard some of them already, but we'll review a few more that have been raised by Tan et al. We'll provide an overview of how our association has responded on behalf of our members to the release of this study. We'll then turn and provide an overview of the functions of a tire, tire manufacturing, and tire materials, including the functions that 6PPD serves in manufacturing safe tires. And last, I want to reiterate our commitment to supporting the alternatives analysis process and working with DTSC on that. And we can go to the next slide. So I'm going to turn it over to Julie to talk through these two distinct materials.
Thanks, Sarah. I think we have heard the 6PPD and 6PPD quinone being discussed here this morning. So I think it is important to remember that these are two distinct materials. 6PPD is a tire material, a direct ingredient used in the manufacturing of tires. And its purpose is to serve as both an antioxidant and antioxidant to protect the tire and prevent it from degrading. It also serves to minimize thermal degradation of the tire. 6PPD quinone, on the other hand, as Ed has explained, is a transformation product of 6PPD quinone, identified for the first time by Tian et al. In the December 2020 publication. So with that, please keep those in mind. Howard is going to talk about 6PPD as a tire material and its function in just a minute. Next slide, please. So Sarah mentioned USTMA members are committed to working collaboratively to conduct the alternatives analysis. And to that end, the members have spent some time thinking about what information is necessary to collect and to understand in order to perform the alternatives analysis. And the data gaps that we have identified fall into really four main buckets, and Ed has touched on a couple of these. But the four buckets are toxicity, environmental fate and distribution, information about alternatives, and really some more information regarding the coho salmon specifically. And so in terms of toxicity, you'll hear from a later speaker regarding the mechanism of urban mortality syndrome in the coho. So what actually happens in the coho to cause this mortality that's observed. But what we don't know is how 6PPD quinone specifically causes those mechanisms to happen. And it's really important in screening other potentially functional alternatives. So maybe chemistries that can functionally perform like 6PPD, in order to screen those for toxicity to the coho, we really need to understand how that happens. Like, what is that mechanism with the 6PPD quinone? And as Ed and a few others have mentioned, we don't really have any information on mammalian toxicity of 6PPD quinone. And so that remains a data gap to understand the potential for human health effects. Ed has mentioned a few of the environmental fate and transport or distribution data gaps. And excuse me, we concur with those that he has mentioned. We are missing some very basic physical and chemical properties of the 6PPD quinone that would be helpful in predicting and anticipating where 6PPD quinone goes in the environment, as well as really understanding the mechanism of how it is formed. So the existing research shows the ozonation pathway in the laboratory, but really understanding how that happens in the environment is also important. With respect to alternatives, I think it was just talked about in a previous question, whether or not the alternatives might also be toxic to aquatic species, and whether or not any of those other PPDs that might be alternatives can form a quinone structure that would have a toxicity like 6PPD quinone does. And then lastly, I think Ed mentioned this at the beginning of his presentation, but it was our understanding that the coho species in the Great Lakes region are successfully spawning. So maybe we'll learn a little bit more about that. But we're wondering what the differences are in the coho in different areas and whether or not anything at the species level might also be contributing to the sensitivity of the species. And then also wondering what maybe some of the other factors are that could be impacting the coho in addition to the 6-PPD quinone. So those are data gaps that we believe need to be filled as we go through this alternatives analysis. USTMA is very open to working collaboratively. The quicker we can get to these answers, the better. And so understanding what other researchers are doing so as to not duplicate efforts would also be good. And Sarah, I'm going to turn it back over to you. Next slide, please.
So just a little bit of an overview of how USTMA responded to the release of the TN et al. Study in 2020. First, we have engaged with researchers and stakeholders to advance the understanding of 6-PPD quinone. And as Julie mentioned, and I'll reiterate again, we welcome the opportunity for continued engagement. If we haven't had a chance to have a dialogue with you and you're interested in speaking with us, we'd love that opportunity. As a little bit of background, in 2019, you heard yesterday, Dr. Kathy Peter shared her research around materials that may be causing toxicity to coho salmon from roadway runoff, and that certain materials were identified as potentially coming from tires. And that research really led to our initial outreach with the Department of Ecology, the University of Washington, the Washington Stormwater Center with Ed and his colleagues to share information about how the tire industry projects under the World Business Council for Sustainable Development had developed several methodologies for studying and assessing tire and roadway particles that we really wanted to share with those researchers. Additionally, we held several meetings with other state agencies also in California, Washington, and Alaska. We've also met with representatives from NIST, NOAA, and the San Francisco Estuary Institute, again, to share methodologies on studying tire wear. And most recently, we met with the US EPA to share our response and to engage with the agency on this issue. Again, I can't emphasize enough, we welcome the opportunity for continued engagement with all stakeholders. And Sarah Ryan, I definitely appreciated your presentation this morning, and we welcome the opportunity to engage with you as well. The second action that we took, which Julie mentioned, was to form a global task group of experts to look at the TN et al. Study and identify relevant data gaps. And Julie just reviewed the data gaps, and there is definitely a need for more research. We have more questions than answers at this point, including where does 6-PPD quinone go in the environment, and also is 6-PPD quinone toxic to other aquatic species? And the third action we took just 3 weeks after the study was released was I sent a letter to Meredith Williams at the Department of Toxic Substances Control, and we asked DTSC to add 6-PPD in tires to the work plan. So in December of last year, DTSC was working on their 2021-2023 draft work plan. We knew that we wanted to choose a framework that was transparent, science-based, rigorous, and provided regulatory oversight in order for us to analyze whether an alternative exists that we can ensure both tire safety and environmental protection. And we were pleased that DTSC accepted our request and finalized the 2021-2023 work plan, which includes 6-PPD in tires, and that the department has continued to advance 6-PPD in tires through the regulatory process towards an alternatives analysis. I want to also emphasize that our members are also continuously engaged in research and development activities to identify the best materials for use in tires to ensure both consumer safety and environmental protection. And we are working to coordinate with chemical suppliers on this issue as well. And now we can go to the next slide. So I'm going to turn it over to Howard to talk through a little bit of background information about the functions of a tire, tire manufacturing, tire materials, and also the role of 6-PPD in manufacturing safe tires. So Howard, I'll turn it over to you.
Okay, thank you, Sarah. Again, thank everybody for their time and taking part in this meeting. Next slide, please. I'll not read all these. I would encourage you to read them as I talk, but as a customer, as a consumer of tires, my expectation, I'm sure yours are as well, is that I really don't want to think about tires. They're something that they're a grudge purchase. We buy them when we need them. But basically, when we stop to consider what a tire does, it really is the only point of contact between the vehicle and the road. And as such, all our braking, acceleration, much of our rolling resistance, fuel economy comes from the tire. We expect it to do all these things and even contradictory things, such as converting heat or energy in the car to heat when you hit the brakes. We also expect it to, as we go down the highway, not to convert energy into heat because we want good gas mileage. We want every bit of the engine performance to be toward moving the car and not hysteresis in the tire. Next slide, please. A worker at an OEM auto manufacturer commented that the tire is the most highly engineered product in an automobile. I think this slide illustrates that. In the industry, we have 10 to 15 different rubber compounds that we use, and each is formulated for a specific function. And these functions are different. Some of the rubbers are harder, some of the rubbers are softer, some of them are focused on flexing. Other ones you don't want to flex very much. And so the compounds are all different, and not only by part, but by company. Each company, tire company, has their own formulation for each individual part of the tire. We use about 45 to 60 unique materials in the tire. They go into all these compounds that you see on the left here. And it's not just that they go into these compounds, it's the way they go into them, how the materials are mixed, and how these compounds are put together to form this tire, which makes it such an engineered marvel. If you would, next slide, please. And as I indicated before, really safety is our priority. There's an incredible amount of work that goes into the tire. It's something that we don't want to make a mistake on. And so, again, we are highly regulated. And the regulation is to ensure consumer safety. We're regulated by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, and you can see the USC regulation that we're under. And it's important to realize that as we change any material in a tire, we're going to change potentially our ability to meet these standards. Whether a change is mandated by legislation or whether a change is something that a tire company does to improve their performance, an incredible amount of testing must be done. Very expensive testing has to be done to prove that the product not only performs as we expect it to, but it performs in such a manner that it's safe still. Next slide, please. Again, here's some of the materials that go into tires. Of course, rubber, synthetic elastomers, and natural rubber. We use processing aids to get the material through all the various operations in the tire plant so we can put the compounds together. We use fillers, carbon black and silica primarily, in the tire for strength. What we're talking about today, the 6-PPD, is added for protection. And as was pointed out, I think, by the first speaker, you saw parts that didn't have 6-PPD in it. And actually, once the PPD goes away, you can actually have a catastrophic failure. Textiles are used, polyamides, polyesters, PET. Steel, a very important part of all tires, more so on truck than even passenger, but both use a significant amount of steel for strength. And we use curing systems. We convert basically a very soft, rubbery compound into the product that we see on the road today. Next slide, please. Here's an example of one of those components. We talked about the number of components in a tire. This is a simplified version of what goes into one of those. For example, the tread rubber. The tread rubber has, or the tread compound has more rubber in it, more weight than the rest of the components that we talked about. It's also the part that comes in direct contact with the road. You can see we have the styrene butadiene rubber. We have polybutadiene rubber hysis. We use natural rubber. The fillers, the extender oils, all part of the curing system, the stearic acid, the zinc, sulfur, and the accelerators. The protection material, though, primarily is 6 PPD, and that is one of the major materials used in a tire to get the long-term performance. It protects the tire from oxygen and ozone. Next slide, please. Okay, so the role of 6 PPD here, and some of this has been alluded to already, but we'll go into a little bit more detail. If you could go to the next slide. Okay, antioxidants and antioxidants prevent degradation and cracking of the rubber compound. And this cracking is caused by oxygen, ozone, and this is affected by temperature. And it can happen either at dynamic conditions, that is when the tire is operating, or under static conditions, when the tire is sitting in your driveway or is stored in a warehouse. The antioxidants help keep the rubber from breaking down due to the temperature and oxygen effects. The antioxidants are used to impede the exposure to ozone, which is in our atmosphere, on the surface of the tire. Next slide, please. And here's another diagram showing the effect of the stabilizer and no stabilizer. It's used by all USTMA members because it is the most effective antioxidant and antioxidant. It actually serves both functions, and it protects the rubber during both dynamic conditions and static conditions to prevent the degradation and cracking. Without the use of this materials like this, the tire will crack and degrade very rapidly, potentially leading to a catastrophic failure. Next slide, please. So what are the expectations for this dynamic protection as we're driving down the road? As alluded to earlier, it needs to be present at the surface. That's where the ozone is, and it has to be continuously present. So if it's used up and there's no source of material inside the tire, then there's an issue. The ozone protection will go away. It has to have good solubility, and perhaps even better to say the proper solubility. It has to be able to diffuse at a certain rate in the rubber compound, fast enough to get to the surface, but not so fast that it's all used up before the tire is worn out. It needs to be reactive with ozone, but again, not too reactive, because if it's too reactive, it will be used up on the surface before more can come to the surface. So again, it's very much a balancing act. Whatever you use as a stabilizer, an antioxidant for tires, it has to do all these things. It can't affect the rubber processing. There are materials that are known to be antioxidants, but have been abandoned by the industry because you simply couldn't process it. We could go into more detail if there are questions on that, but you simply can't process with those materials. It needs to be available in the rubber compound over its entire life cycle to be sure the rubber's protected for the entire life cycle. And really, we're looking for materials that are low toxicity for both the material itself. And as we've come to see here in this particular meeting, we have to be very cognizant of the byproducts or the reaction products of the of whatever material is being used. Next slide. On this one, Julie, I'm going to turn this back over to you for the rest of this. So,
Okay, thanks, Howard. So as Howard mentioned, the characteristics of the protection materials are that they need to be able to move through the rubber compounds to get to the surface at a specific rate to react with the oxygen and the ozone in the air. And 6-PPD does just that. And the rubber and tire industry have investigated the reaction mechanisms over time to understand byproduct transformation products, including the Latimer paper that Ed mentioned. However, prior to Tian et al., 6-PPD quinone was not known to be a transformation product. So the ones that were known to the industry have been looked at. There is a paper by Eunice et al. That specifically looked at 6-PPD and its transformation products in the environment. Next slide. Okay, back to you, Sarah.
Thanks. So I want to reiterate our commitment to supporting DTSC through this alternatives analysis process. And again, soon after the study came out, within just a few days, we got questions to the industry, is there a safer alternative? And our response to that question was to find a regulatory framework, which is the Safer Consumer Products Regulation process, that provides that regulatory oversight through a robust, transparent, scientific-based process to analyze whether alternatives exist. And again, we supported and asked DTSC to review 6-PPD and tires only 3 weeks after the study was released. And I think that's pretty unprecedented for an industry to do, and it's something we thought was incredibly important. And we are committed to working with DTSC as expeditiously as possible to advance the alternatives analysis. As Julie mentioned, we also want to be a partner in working on any additional research. As we've talked about, there are many data gaps surrounding 6-PPD quinone. We truly believe that if we can all work together, we can advance filling these data gaps faster than going it alone. With that, I want to thank DTSC for your time, for the opportunity to present today, and we're happy to take any questions you might have.
Next slide, please. One more. Thank you very much. Okay, so we'll now be taking some questions regarding United States Tire Manufacturers Association presentation. If you have any questions or comments, please click the Q&A button below, *9 to raise your hand by phone, and you can also email Safer Consumer Products. So it looks like we already have a couple questions in here. First one says, there are very limited types of tires without 6-PPD, correct? Non-marking tires, white tires. What anti-degradants are used in these tires?
I may ask Howard to jump in here, but non-marking tires might be tires used on a forklift used inside a building, and those tires are not required to meet federal motor vehicle safety standards. Howard, I don't know if you have any insights on those types of tires.
Yes, I'm not an expert in that area, but as Sarah pointed out, those will not be subject to the same regulations. Typically, those type of tires don't have nearly the dynamic requirements of a passenger or a truck tire. Many times, these are like lawnmower, and perhaps I'm misstating this, but lawnmower tires or golf cart tires, there's a whole family of those type materials. I don't know if they have 6-PPD in them or not. The white ones obviously do not, because the 6-PPD is staining. But I can't really comment other than that.
Okay, so moving on. Says, how can we be confident that the mortality in the Great Lakes is not occurring? Some work has detected 6-PPD quinone at concentrations above LC50 in rivers that discharge into Lake Ontario, for example.
So it's definitely something we talked with our Canadian colleagues at the Tire and Rubber Association of Canada, and they tried to work and get in touch with the Canadian authorities to learn more about the coho populations, particularly in the Toronto area. But there was limited data we could find online about any mortality events similar to what was occurring in Washington State. I think it's definitely an area that warrants additional investigation to see, is there something unique about the coho in Washington versus the coho in the Great Lakes?
Thank you. So next one says, this one's long. So what are some chemicals currently being investigated as potential alternatives to 6-PPD? What chemicals should be investigated? There's also a related question that says, are these alternative evaluations focused exclusively on performance, or do they include an assessment of the environment, fate, and toxicity of potential alternatives?
So the California Safer Consumer Products Regulation, I'm sure all the DTSC folks can speak much more eloquently about this than I can, but it not only requires a look at the technical performance of a particular chemistry in a product, but also any environmental impacts. And so both must be assessed as we look at alternatives. And both are important questions to be asked, and we will be evaluating those as we move through the alternatives analysis process.
All right, so it looks like this will be the last question, but it says, if an alternative anti-ozonation chemical is identified, will it be proprietary to USTMA members, or will it be widely known to others?
I can't predict the outcome of the alternatives analysis process at this time. I think we are working as hard as we can and as fast as we can supporting DTSC on the alternatives analysis process, and will utilize their framework to evaluate alternatives, both from a performance impact and also from an environmental impact.
Okay. Let's see. Looks like we have actually one more question time. So it says, what are some chemicals currently being investigated as, this was part of the original question. It says, what are some chemicals currently being investigated as a potential alternative to 6-PPD, and what chemicals should be investigated?
I think those are all great questions to be evaluated as part of the alternatives analysis process. I do know there are other antioxidants and antiozonants in the same PPD family of chemicals. And it's a question, do they cause the same toxic effect on coho as 6-PPD? That's a data gap. And it's an important one to fill, because we wouldn't want to use any alternative chemical that could cause similar or other environmental impacts. So it's important that we have that data so we can make an informed decision about alternatives.
All right, thank you. So that concludes our Q&A session on the USTMA's presentation. I will now invite Mr. Andrew Patterson of the Eurofins Environmental Testing America to present. Next slide, please.
Good morning. Still the morning.
It looks like we're having some audio problems. We heard you for a second. It looks like you're on mute. Okay, let's try it again. No.
Without a headset.
Oh, better.
Is that coming through at all now?
Yes, perfect.
Can anyone hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you now.
We can hear you.
Yeah. Okay. Well, that's good. Okay. So I'm seeing people nodding, so I'm assuming people can hear me, but you know, that's how these things go. Thank you to the DTSC for having me here today. My name is Andrew Patterson. I'm the technical director here at Eurofins. I'm coming to you from West Sacramento. And we were asked just about the day the paper came out in Science, to take a look at this. We were asked from a pretty high level, and we jumped on it. So it was both stressful and really rewarding to try to come up with the first commercial method to make this happen. Next slide, please. The U.S. tire manufacturer touched on this, that 6-PBD, the parent compound, is not 6-PBD quinone. And in fact, it's only through the process of protecting the tire from ozone that the quinone is formed. I feel like everybody has a lot better grasp on this than early this morning. This has been a great workshop. I'm really honored to be a part of it. But 6-PBD quinone is not added to the tires and only forms in the process of protecting the tire from oxygen. Next slide, please. So we do have an analysis for several different matrices. We'll focus on aqueous first. How is the analysis performed? We at Eurofins, like, we have a sustainability initiative where we're not trying to send out giant liters of bottle all around the world with armies of coolers. So we can perform this analysis with a reporting limit of 10 ppt using just 50 mils. So that's what we deploy out into the field. That's a 50 mil polypropylene centrifuge bottle. And the first thing we do when it gets back to our lab is we add a deuterated standard. It's a stable isotope. It's exactly the same structure with the exception of some deuterium ions instead of hydrogen. But what that's going to do is allow us to have isotope dilution quantitation. And so we will get a loss corrected value in the presence of difficult matrix or anything else that may happen during the process. So we first add that standard to your sample. And then we run through SPE, or solid phase extraction, that removes interferences and both removes interferences and concentrates the analyte. We send that over to the instruments. Those are three SciX X500 QTOFs. We're also using a QTOF, much like the team at UW did, but we're using it out of an abundance of caution, and we'll go into that in a little bit. But if everything turns out, what you get at the bench level is a nice chromatogram like that on the right, where we can distinguish our isotope that's on the very bottom, and the other two ions above that are the quantitation and confirmation ion. So if everything works, we can perform some quantitation down to a reporting limit of 10 ppt on your aqueous samples, and we'll talk about solids and some other things as we go on. This presentation really isn't meant to be salesy. It really is just a ride along on how we approach emerging contaminants. I split my time between more established analyses like PFAS and dioxins, and then we also do want to be able to jump on things like this. So this is more of an overview of everything that we can do. Next slide. So why are we using a QTOF? It's a little bit like taking a Ferrari to the grocery store. What it really does is it adds confidence in an emerging contaminant where we might not know the interferences. And so part of what we're doing is evaluating data on both a QTOF, that instrument, and then also a more traditional instrument, or a triple quad. And what we're doing is we're observing possible interferences so that we can decide when a prudent time would be to move that analysis to a lesser platform. But this instrument measures the time of flight of compounds. Ed talked about that a little bit, but we're using exact mass to overcome possible interferences that's going to add that confidence. The last thing we would want to do is to report false positives. And this tool helps us do that. In conclusion, on this slide, high resolution data can add confidence by mitigating the potential for interferences. So it's not overkill yet, because we really don't have a firm grasp on what's happening. Folks ask us, are using the UW method to extract waters? And really, that wasn't their focus. Their focus was identification. So that big soup from roadway runoff, we have to pluck out 6-PBD quinone out of that soup without very much processing. So we started from scratch. Everything we're doing is under the QA/QC framework of ISO 17025. So there's no certification available yet, but when the time comes, we'll hopefully be the first one to get it. Next slide. So folks have also asked us, well, why aren't you looking for 6-PBD? Well, because 6-PBD is designed to react and it does just that. That graph on the left there, what that represents is we aliquoted the parent compound, 6-PBD, into methanol, and we kept it in the dark in the fridge, and we pulled a new vial every day, and we watched over a very fast period of time the 6-PBD response degrade. It's down to about 50% in 5 days. So if you can't have a stable calibration curve, there's no way you're going to have a stable analysis, and there's no way you can defend that quantitation. On those same injections, we also noticed that we were forming the quinone. So really, there's almost no way to simultaneously look at the 6-PBD and the 6-PBD quinone if we can't even do it in organic solvents. We briefly tried to see if anything would slow this degradation, and we really couldn't. And so it's for that reason that we are focusing on the quinone as a primary toxicant. And we are monitoring for 6-PBD in the background, just to give us an idea of what's happening. But really, it's really the quinone that we're focused on. Next slide. Sitting, coming to you from, well, this audience is perfect. Coming to you from California, we need rain. We need rain badly. And I was hoping to get some rain to collect before this talk, and we couldn't get it. So what's the next best thing? Car washes. So we armed ourselves with some bottles and went to the car wash. One of those couple automated car washes, but this was the first one. Everyone knows the triple color foam is the best part. It's oddly relaxing. But after the car wash, we kind of hop back in quickly before the water drain. It drains really quickly. There's some large drains there, and we were furiously scooping up what we could. And there's two of the samples, the initial samples we had. You can see that they are different, and they are pretty complex. We put that through our SB process and on the instruments, and bam, we found quite a bit, we think. So whenever a chromatographer puts up nice chromatograms when they have basically gross sludge, they're patting themselves on the back. But really, it's a combination of our cleanup and the heavy lifting done by the QTOF instrumentation. If you can go ahead and click. So here's what we found. We found concentrations not near our reporting limit of 10 ppt, but we found them in the ppb range. And you can see that those are just under 1 ppb to almost 3 ppb or micrograms per liter. And they were pulling that graphic from the Tiana et al. Paper, and you can see that a car wash suddenly becomes a lot like a multi-lane runway, roadway runoff or receiving waters. So this was eye-opening. We didn't have this during our initial method development, but it would have been great. We were too busy trying to focus on our own parking lot with some lower level detections, but really the car wash seems to have a nice, well, not nice, but it seems to have a high concentration of the quinone to work with. So next slide, please. So we decided to try it again. Like good scientists, we want to be able to repeat it. You can see that we had a pretty sophisticated collection system there with some bottles taped to the bumper of my truck. And that was, we were thinking that the car wash, you know, it has to recycle water, which is a great idea. But in the process, is it using that recycled water? Is it concentrating the 6-PBD quinone? And so you can see that this is very recent. That's my left-handed scrawling of what we got there. And these bottles were open the entire time of the car wash. You can see we collected a lot of different detergents and colored everything there. But that came up with 350 ppt or 0.35 ppb just directly from the nozzle. So this would be... this was a solution that didn't ever touch the ground of the car wash. So it is coming through those nozzles. But more importantly, this wasn't a fluke. We went to 3 different car washes. My truck was really clean that day and collected several different samples, both from the floor of the car wash. And you can see how those turned out. We're well into the PVB range. And in fact, one of the car washes that was a little more heavily laden with sediment was up at 18 micrograms per liter, 18 PVB. So, you know, this water doesn't necessarily flow to a stream or a creek, but, you know, you take the number of car washes in the greater Sacramento area or any city, and that some of that is definitely going to the wastewater treatment plant. And we do think there's a data gap. You know, how do wastewater treatment plants deal with this? And we just don't know. Again, when we bring up methods, we try to stress our cleanup, we try to stress our instruments and see how we can stump them. And so this didn't stump us, but it was pretty eye-opening. Next slide. Next slide, please. Again, going through different matrices here, this was a wipe test done on a tire. And this was early on, but what we were trying to do is just to get the idea, how is 6 PVD quinone distributed on a tire? And so we did a wipe test of the sidewall and a wipe test of the tread area. And you can see on the left there that the quinone is predominantly detected. If we take the concentration as a whole, it's driven towards the sidewall over the tread. And this was a tire that was just an old used tire, but it really did have a lot of tread left on it. But interestingly enough, the parent compound, the 6 PVD tire distribution, didn't match that same pattern. Again, we didn't really dive too deeply into this, just that it's interesting that the fact that the parent compound and the degradant compound have a different pattern just physically sitting on a tire that's not mounted on a vehicle. So could we do a wipe sample in the future? Yes, we can do wipe samples, and we think that there may be a need for wipe samples. Next slide. So bit of good news here. We're testing out different matrices, and I was driving up and down I-5 and noticed a lot of bee boxes, and there's a lot of apiaries in this area. And so we did test some honey, and bees have it tough enough already with neonic pesticides and everything else that we throw at them. So all three honey samples were non-detect, but you can see that this slide's really illustrative of our isodilution technique, where those peaks that you're seeing on the right, those are our isotopes. That's the deuterated 6 PPD quinone. And you can see that it's nice peak shape. And we do have similar values in between our internal standard, which is on the right, our calibration standard, and our sample. So this would tell us that if 6 PPD quinone was there, we would be able to detect it. But in this case, all three samples had a non-detect down to 0.25 nanogram per gram. So that was good news. Next slide. I am trying to hustle here. I know I'm running low on time. When we were developing our solid method, we needed some soil. So the easiest thing to do was go out to a planter box, grab a little bit of soil, and lo and behold, we found it. We found 5 nanograms per gram of 6 PPD quinone in the planter box. But interestingly, we didn't see any 6 PPD. So kind of scratching our heads about this still. Maybe it's the quick degradation from the parent compound into the quinone, or it's not being deposited there on a regular basis. But if you can click. There we go. One thing though, so that is our building, that white building down there in the bottom right. And that planter box is that exact planter box that you're seeing. We are right next to a government test track. It's a test track that they go very fast on most of the day. And so, you know, are we getting more tire wear particles than the average person than would be without a test track there? We just don't know. Is there some sort of atmospheric deposition going on? This was something really was designed to take a snapshot of how our method deals with solid samples, but it did get us thinking about various ways that we could get that quinone in our planter box. Next slide. With that, I know I went a little bit over, but please don't hesitate to shoot me an email or any of us there. We're really passionate about this. We just want to get it right. Again, we know we're using a cue, which is a high-end instrument, but we're doing that out of an abundance of caution. We'd be glad to work with anybody on both sides of the fence. We're an analytical laboratory. We literally have to be down the middle of the road just to maintain our integrity. And so really love to hear more about this. I like where it's going. I'm honored to be a part of this workshop, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Patterson. Okay, so we'll now be doing a short Q&A on Mr. Patterson's presentation. Next slide, please. Once again, if you can press *9 by phone, go ahead and email your question or click Q&A at the bottom. It looks like our first question says, can you comment on the likely stability of 6 ppd quinone in the environment based on your methodology work? I'll repeat that one more time. It says, can you comment on the likely stability of the 6 ppd quinone in the environment based on your methodology work?
You know, I only heard part of that. You guys hear me now?
Yes.
Could you repeat?
Would you like me to repeat it?
Yes, please. Thank you.
Can you comment on the likely stability of 6 ppd quinone in the environment based on your methodology work?
I can't comment on the long-term stability, but as far as on being able to deliver a stable calibration curve, we're very happy with the 6 ppd quinone. There are standards available from both HPC and from CIL, Cambridge Isotope Laboratories, available now, and we are utilizing a second source standard to confirm our concentrations. And so both standards seem very stable.
All right, thank you. So the only other question that we have time for right now, we have one more, but we will have an opportunity to answer questions at the very end. So the last question that we have for you, Mr. Patterson, says, who funded this research?
Europeans itself. This is part of our method development efforts. Whenever anything new comes our way, we're doing a lot of these same steps. We decided, because of the importance of this emerging contaminant, to open it up a little more than we usually would with the public.
All right, thank you so much. So this concludes our Q&A session on Mr. Patterson's presentation. I would now like to invite Ms. Stephanie Blair of Washington State University to present. Following the Q&A for her presentation, we'll be taking public comments. So please enter those in the Q&A or email Safer Consumer Products. Ms. Blair, next slide, please.
Yes, thank you so much. Very appreciative to be participating in this workshop today. I'm a PhD candidate working with my advisor, Dr. Jennifer McIntyre. I started working with her in 2016, back when I was a master's student, and have continued my research in the mechanisms of toxicity in coho urban runoff mortality syndrome. So today I'd like to share some of the highlights of the research conducted by our group, including some of the thesis research of my work on the blood-brain barrier. Next slide, please. Before I get into the details, I'd like to first acknowledge our partners, our supporters, and our amazing core team at Washington State University's Puyallup Research and Extension Center, NOAA's Northwest Fishery Science Center, University of Washington Tacoma Center for Urban Waters, and the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. As you can see from the range of tribal, business, and government groups that are represented by our partners and supporters, it really speaks to the urgency and importance of this issue, bringing in partners from tribal business groups and governmental groups that really want to address the problem of urban stormwater pollution, particularly as it pertains to its effects on salmon habitat. Next slide, please. And as Dr. Ed Kaloje was pointing out, I'd like to really highlight and emphasize what he was saying about how difficult it is to gather data pertaining to coho pre-spawn mortalities. So this was a very intensive effort. Observations of this phenomenon began in the 1980s, but really it wasn't until the 1990s that pre-spawn mortalities in these urban streams were routinely monitored and recorded. So this required a coordination of volunteer efforts where members of the community were donating their time to come out and walk reaches of these streams. Oh, please go back to the previous slide. Volunteers were out walking the streams, looking for coho salmon carcasses every single day. And it took years of gathering data across multiple basins to be able to understand the extent of this phenomenon and for us to begin our work that has led up to what we're discussing today. So these volunteers were finding coho carcasses that you see in the picture here, rather than being empty of eggs, indicating that they had completed their life cycle successfully. A striking number of the coho female carcasses were full of eggs, indicating that she had died before spawning. And after careful work done by our partners at NOAA's Northwest Fisheries Science Center, it emerged that these coho were not dying from any known cause of fish mortality, and anecdotal evidence linked the timing of these die-offs to rainfall events, which then connected an unknown contaminant in stormwater as the cause. Next slide, please. To give you an idea just how high the pre-spawn mortality rates in these urban streams were, here's a figure of coho pre-spawn mortality rates along the y-axis. Along the x-axis, it's showing three Seattle area creeks: Longfellow Creek over a couple of years, Des Moines Creek, and Piper's Creek, where the pre-spawn mortality rates were between 63 and 100%. On the far right is a non-urban creek called Fortson Creek, which tells us that in the absence of stormwater runoff inputs, coho pre-spawn mortality rates should be less than 1%. Because of the extremely high rates of coho pre-spawn mortality, coho populations in these creeks are unsustainable and will continue to be so unless the problem of urban stormwater runoff is addressed. Next slide, please. We know, based on landscape analyses and coho population modeling conducted by our partners at NOAA's Northwest Fisheries Science Center and U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, that exposure to urban stormwater presents a survival risk to coho that is large in both scale and magnitude. The landscape characteristics that were important predictors of where coho pre-spawn mortalities were observed included percent urbanization, road density, and traffic intensity. And this provided important early clues that vehicles may be a source of these contaminants. Oh, please go back. We know based on population models that pre-spawn mortality rates above 10% are at risk for extinction. And in the figure on the right is showing you that 20% pre-spawn mortality corresponds to a modeled time to extinction of 135 years. And that time becomes much shorter at higher pre-spawn mortality rates. The map of the Puget Sound region is showing areas in red and yellow where coho are predicted to be at risk for extinction. And an important takeaway from this map for those of you living in California is that it's not just the basins that are the most heavily urbanized, such as Seattle and Tacoma, that are most at risk, but also includes the surrounding suburban regions as well. So anywhere where we have roads, we have tires, these may also present a level of risk. Even for salmon that spawn in the green upper watersheds with low predicted pre-spawn mortality, these salmon may become exposed to degraded water quality when migrating through the more developed and urbanized lowland areas as juveniles and as adults. And as I will share in upcoming slides, even a short runoff exposure window may have an impact on coho. So therefore, all coho that rear and spawn and migrate through habitats that receive inputs of urban runoff may be at risk. Next slide, please. In early experiments that were conducted by our group working with roadway runoff, we confirmed what the landscape studies were suggesting, that the roadways and vehicles were a source of contaminants that were lethal to coho. And this predated our work on tire leachate that Dr. Kaloje had shared. So shown in this picture is a stretch of road where we collected roadway runoff from a stretch of State Route 520 in Seattle, Washington, shown above. And the runoff sitting in the beaker at the bottom right is dark and cloudy, indicating the high amount of material that's washing off these roadways when it rains. Next slide, please. An initial study working with the Suquamish tribe of Washington State, the runoff was brought to their Grover's Creek hatchery, and the adult coho spawners that were returning there were exposed to either clean well water, 100% roadway runoff, or roadway runoff that was filtered using bioretention, which is an inexpensive mixture of sand and compost that's designed to treat the runoff. The coho were placed inside the PVC tubes, as Dr. Kaloje had shown earlier in the tera leachate experiment, and those tubes are placed in each of these tanks, which were then exposed to one of the three treatments for 4 or 24 hours. Next slide, please. After just 4 hours of exposure, the coho were removed from the PVC tubes and placed in an observation tank to monitor their behavior. The control coho exposed to clean well water were swimming normally, but the coho exposed to the runoff for just 4 hours were not. They were lethargic, unable to hold themselves upright in the water, called loss of equilibrium. All of the coho exposed to the runoff for the 4 or 24 hours died, but the control and bioretention treated runoff exposed coho survived and they were swimming normally. And this demonstrated that bioretention was effective at removing the toxicity of runoff to coho. And as was mentioned earlier, at the time of this experiment, adult coho were also exposed to suspected stormwater contaminants such as metals and PAHs. And this did not elicit the symptoms that you're seeing here or lead to any coho deaths, which again confirmed that the causative agent was still then unknown. Next slide, please. After repeated experiments, it was clear that the roadway runoff was consistently lethal to adult coho salmon. But due to limitations in conducting experiments with the fall adult spawners, our group turned their attention to the juvenile coho. And we found that juvenile coho were just as sensitive as the adults. Both of them exhibited the same progression of behaviors and symptoms, including the surface swimming, loss of equilibrium, and death. And these same symptoms were observed in urban streams following rainfall events. The figure is here showing a graphical representation of that surfacing behavior. Along the x-axis is the exposure time of the juvenile coho to 100% runoff. And along the y-axis is the surface swimming rate. So here we're seeing that the juvenile coho begins surface swimming at about 45 minutes, which continues until death, which can occur in about 4 to 5 hours. And importantly, once the juvenile coho had initiated the surface swimming behavior, moving them to clean water did not prevent their deaths. Next slide, please. In follow-up studies using juvenile coho, we also learned that high dilutions of the runoff were necessary to prevent mortality. This figure is showing the dose response relationships between coho percent mortality after 24 hours of exposure along the y-axis and the percentage of stormwater diluted in clean lab water. When stormwater was diluted, it remained toxic to coho down to a 5% dilution. And at a 25% dilution, the stormwater continued to prove to be consistently and nearly completely lethal across 3 runoff sampling events. Next slide, please. And the juvenile coho need only to be exposed to a lethal dose of runoff for a very short time in order to lead to death. In a recent experiment, juvenile coho were exposed to 25% roadway runoff in a series of different exposure durations before being transferred to clean lab water and monitored for up to 24 hours for mortality. The black bars in this figure are indicating that the coho died when it was still in the runoff, and the white bars indicate that the fish had died after being moved to clean water. Some of the coho that were exposed to runoff for as little as 1 hour died, with a significant increase in mortality after 2 hours. This is indicating that the fish are taking up the contaminant very rapidly and that the initiating events that lead to death are happening early in the exposure window, which again is not reversible when the fish are moved to clean water. Next slide, please. So what are these initiating events? Coho urban runoff mortality syndrome refers to a consistent suite of behavioral and physiological symptoms that are observed in both the field and lab experiments, including coho exposed to 6 ppd quinone. The video on the left is an adult coho in Longfellow Creek in Seattle that's showing symptoms similar to what we saw earlier in the fish exposed to 6 ppd, and also in the juvenile coho to the right, exposed to 50% roadway runoff. These symptoms are surfacing, loss of equilibrium, and death within around 4 to 6 hours. The surfacing behavior and gaping indicates that the fish are literally suffocating in the water, suffering from some type of cardiorespiratory distress. They also show signs of neurological impairment from behaviors such as fin splaying and loss of equilibrium, which occur immediately before death. Next slide, please. Our group has studied a range of blood parameters to identify a plausible toxic mode of action related to cardiorespiratory distress. While several blood changes were observed, such as decrease in blood plasma pH and electrolytes, the most notable change was that the blood of the runoff exposed coho became much thicker relative to control groups. We measured coho blood thickness by their hematocrit, which is defined as the percent volume of the blood that's taken up by red blood cells. So the higher the hematocrit, the thicker the blood, the higher the proportion of red blood cells relative to blood plasma. The figure showing hematocrit values of juvenile coho exposed to control water and 50% roadway runoff until the runoff exposed coho reached the loss of equilibrium phase. Each point is showing the hematocrit value of an individual fish, and the black dot in bars are showing the average and standard deviation of each group respectively. As a group, the runoff coho show consistent rises in hematocrit relative to the control group, with some of the runoff fish reaching hematocrit levels as high as 70 to 80%. This severity of this increase indicates that the hematocrit rises may not just be from a stress response, but pathologically related to death. For instance, hematocrit levels of 70 to 80% are well above those that are observed in fish exposed to exercise stress. And because 70 to 80% hematocrit becomes so thick that it can slow the circulation and promote clotting, slow circulation impairs oxygen delivery, which might explain the surfacing behaviors in coho suffering from urban runoff mortality syndrome. So this led us to investigate mechanisms of hematocrit rises in fish and potential related toxic modes of action. Next slide, please. And what came out of that investigation was evidence that pointed to blood-brain barrier disruption as the mechanism that could explain why the hematocrits were so severely increased in runoff-exposed coho and why they were dying so rapidly. The blood-brain barrier in fish serves the same purpose that it does in humans: to protect and carefully maintain the environment of the central nervous system. Only in the fish brain and gills are the blood vessels completely impermeable due to the full lining of the inner walls of the blood vessels by endothelial cells that are firmly joined together by what are called tight junctions. And this forms the blood-brain barrier. When endothelial cell function is disrupted, it can lead to the opening of the tight junctions, like the opening of a gate, allowing blood plasma to freely pass into the central nervous system where it can disrupt neuronal function. To track where the blood plasma was going, we introduced a fluorescent dye into circulation of the fish. The regions where the blood vessels in the brain become permeable due to disruption of the blood-brain barrier, this tracer will cross into the central nervous system and accumulate in the brain, pictured on the right-hand side of this illustration. After the dye is injected, the blood vessels are then washed out with saline to remove the circulating dye, leaving behind just the dye that had crossed into the brain tissue. Next slide, please. And so here's a picture of a coho from this experiment that had been exposed to 50% roadway runoff until reaching the loss of equilibrium stage. The coho was then put under anesthesia and the gills irrigated with water. The body cavity was open to get access to the heart, and the fluorescent dye was injected and circulated for 5 minutes, followed by a 15-minute washout with saline. The successful removal of all of the circulating blood and tracer during the washout step was evident by the gills turning from red to white, as seen in the image. And then the fish were euthanized and their heads were removed and frozen whole in a custom black media for sectioning and imaging. Next slide, please. Layers of tissue were then removed down through the midline of the brain, and images were taken showing where the fluorescent dye had accumulated. The yellow is outlining the region of the brain in these fish. In the runoff group, all of the juvenile coho demonstrated an accumulation of dye in their brains due to blood-brain barrier disruption, whereas the dye was virtually absent in the brains of the control group after the washout step. Next slide, please. And now we're currently in the process of follow-up studies to validate our initial findings of blood-brain barrier breakdown. The images are showing brain sections of coho that were treated with control water or 50% roadway runoff, and then were injected with the tracer called horseradish peroxidase, which stains a dark brown. The control brains show an absence of staining, except for the compartments of the brain that do have permeable vessels, such as the pituitary, which serves as a positive control, showing that if vessels were permeable in other regions of the brain, the staining would have been a similar dark brown. The region of the brain known as the cerebellum was selected for comparison at high magnification, where individual capillaries can be identified. And at this higher magnification, it's clear that the horseradish peroxidase had leaked from the blood vessels and had diffused throughout the central nervous system in the runoff exposed fish, staining the entire tissue a dark brown, which was then completely absent in the controls. The available data confirms that coho are experiencing blood-brain barrier breakdown at the onset of the loss of equilibrium stage, which then leads to death. And the reason that understanding the mechanisms of toxicity in coho urban runoff mortality syndrome is so important is that it enables us to better understand how 6-PBD quinone and urban runoff act so quickly on coho salmon, and also to evaluate whether sublethal toxic effects may be present in other species. Next slide, please. Coho are by far the most sensitive to runoff out of the 5 species of Pacific salmon and trout that we have tested, but there appears to be a sensitivity gradient. Based on a recent study conducted with our partners at NOAA, juvenile steelhead and chinook demonstrated some mortality in response to runoff exposure, but juvenile sockeye did not appear to be overtly affected. Like the juvenile sockeye, adult chum also showed no mortality response to runoff exposure. However, it is likely that Pacific salmon exposed to runoff do demonstrate sublethal effects that may be a cause for concern, particularly for coho, chinook, and steelhead, which will be the focus of future studies. Next slide, please. However, we have demonstrated lethal effects in aquatic invertebrates, such as Daphnia, and then also sublethal effects across several species, especially during their embryonic development. For example, zebrafish and Pacific herring embryos exposed to runoff show slower growth and slower development, with craniofacial abnormalities, such as smaller eye areas and malformed jaws. Runoff exposed fish embryos also have heart deformities and arrhythmias, as well as vascular abnormalities such as bleeding and swelling around their hearts. Next slide. Thank you. In summary, we know from nearly a decade of experiments across multiple studies that coho are highly sensitive to runoff exposure, which elicits the same suite of behaviors and symptoms known as coho urban runoff mortality syndrome that can be attributed to 6-PBD quinone. Next, please. We know that a rapid rise in hematocrit occurs just prior to death, which is concurrent with plasma leakage in the brain due to a disruption in the blood-brain barrier. Next. We observe sublethal effects in zebrafish and herring embryos, as well as some lethal effects in juvenile chinook and steelhead exposed to road runoff. And lastly, it's important to point out that unlike coho, the effects observed in other fish species remain to be directly linked to 6-PBD quinone exposure and not other pollutants in stormwater. And so this is an important focus for future studies as well. Next slide. Thank you everybody for listening. I would be happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Ms. Blair. We'll now be taking some questions on your presentation. So again, go ahead and click the Q&A button at the bottom to enter your question. Press *9 if you're joining by phone, and we'll not be using the chat function. So the first question that we have is, what are the possible implications for human health given the effects of 6-PBD quinone on the blood-brain barrier of coho?
I think we'll need definitely more data to be able to assess risks to human health. There definitely can be differences in the supporting structures of the blood-brain barrier between species, particularly between fish and humans. But I know that there is extensive literature that looks at zebrafish as a model for blood-brain barrier structure and function. So there is something to be said. There's a lot of conservation of those structures that definitely, if we see this is something that's happening in fish, it raises the question where we need to investigate how it affects mammals and definitely humans as well.
Okay, great. It says, have you been able to determine which tight junction proteins are being targeted in coho salmon?
No, we haven't looked at any specific tight junction proteins in coho. We would definitely love to continue with that research, asking those questions in the future.
Great. Next one is pretty long, but it says, were there no regions in the body which the endothelial cell's tight junctions were disrupted, i.e. the dye was only seen in the brain but not other anatomic locations? Is it the increased pressure on the cerebellum that may be the reason for the loss of equilibrium? And can you comment on the P-glycoprotein comment made by Blair 2021, i.e. how is this possibly involved? And might this protein partly explain coho sensitivity? So I'm going to go ahead and try to go through these one at a time, since we did ask people put these in one at a time. It says, were there no regions in the body where endothelial cells tight junctions were disrupted, the dye in the brain, but not any anatomical locations?
So the dye was seen to be diffuse throughout the fish's head. You can see that there is an accumulation in the brain, but we also measured that there was an accumulation in the olfactory rosettes, which we quantified along with the brain regions. So the reason why, you know, we didn't really look at other brain regions beside the brain is because there is some permeability in all of those other blood vessels. So the dye really would only be excluded from the brain due to an intact blood-brain barrier and accumulate when there's a disruption in that barrier. So we weren't particularly surprised to see the dye showing up in other regions of the body, because we knew that those vessels were more permeable.
Okay, and the second part of that question is the increased pressure on the cerebellum that may be the reason for loss of equilibrium?
So we don't necessarily have a definitive point-by-point mechanism to explain what triggers the loss of equilibrium. It was surprising to see how much of the horseradish peroxidase was taken up and diffused throughout the tissue of the runoff-exposed coho. And just those vessels being so permeable to things as large as horseradish peroxidase, which is a medium-sized protein, a lot of material is being allowed to enter in and protect potentially disrupt neuronal function. But we can't say, you know, it was the pressure or necessarily all of this material coming in that triggered that loss of equilibrium.
Okay, and then the last part of that says, can you comment on the P-glycoprotein comment that made in Blair et al. 2021, how it's possibly involved? Might the protein partially explain coho sensitivity?
Well, so there is not a lot of direct research looking at different structures and constituents of the blood-brain barrier. There is some work on these PGP proteins that do show some evidence that it plays a role in an uptake of contaminants, and there can be between species differences in activities. Really, there's going to be a lot more work that needs to be done to explain why coho are more sensitive than other species, which may or may not be related to PGP proteins at all.
Okay. Looks like we have time for just one more question. It says, do you know what happens to the coho spawners that survive a storm event that is causing URMS in some of the fish? And are they able to continue swimming upstream? Is their spawning successful?
So it's So there are some coho that do successfully spawn in streams where we also see the urban runoff mortality syndrome. And again, a lot of the detections that you're seeing in the environment that you saw earlier are at or around the LC50. So that means that some of the fish are going to die at those concentrations, but some that are a little bit more robust will survive. So the fact that the pre-spawn mortality rates that we're finding in these streams is so incredibly high, we know that eventually those populations are going to be headed in a downward trajectory, even though there may be a small amount of fish that do survive.
Great. Thank you so much, Ms. Blair. So that concludes the Q&A on Ms. Blair's presentation. We'll now move on to the public comment period. Read through each of the public comments. Next slide, please. I'll read through each of the public comments. So go ahead and click the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen and we'll read it aloud. You can also click raise hand button or press *9 if you're joining by phone to let us know you'd like to speak. Or you can email us at saferconsumerproducts@dtsc.ca.gov. I'll give a couple moments for people to type in any public comments. Okay, I don't see any hand raised and I don't see any public comments. I'll give another moment before we move on to the question and answer portion. Okay, so it looks like we will be moving on to the question and answer session. If I could have the panelists turn on their camera and prepare for answering responses. I'll go ahead and read the first question. Next slide, please. I'll mention once again that you can click the Q&A button. You can also raise your hand or press *9 by phone. And I'm going to go ahead and start with the questions. Has anyone screened 6-PPD or the 6-PPD quinone, the receptor binding, e.g. AHR? That looks like a no. Okay, I will move on to the next one. This looks like it's a question for USTMA. It says, I would be interested in seeing a summary of the toxicity data for the previously identified transformation products. Please direct me to where the information can be found. Also, why was 6-PPD quinone not previously identified as a transformation product? If a standard test species is or was used for the transformation product testing, it may be hard to detect coho-specific risks.
I think Ed mentioned the Latimer paper, and we can share the, maybe Julie, we can type in the citation into the chat so folks can find that. I'll turn to Julie for a little bit more information about why Latimer didn't identify 6-PPD quinone. Julie, can you elaborate on that?
Yeah, I don't know that specifically. I think from talking with Howard and other polymer chemists, I think was probably just a lack of the modern analytical chemistry equipment and techniques that we have now, but I don't really know for sure why it was confused. I think Ed mentioned that it's possible that Latimer et al. Identified the dinitrone instead of the quinone structure, but I don't really know why specifically that would be the case. With respect to where you can get information on the toxicity of transformation products, the best place that I've been able to find, at least it compiled, is in the ECHA REACH dossier for 6-PPD. Not every transformation product is listed there, but the chemical manufacturers who registered the substance were required to provide aquatic toxicity data for the main transformation products of 6-PPD. So I would look there.
Thank you very much. It looks like this next question is for Ed. It says, does 6 ppd quinone always form 6 ppd in the presence of ozone? Or does it require minimum ozone level to other specific environmental conditions?
Yeah, if I heard that right, ozone reacting with 6 ppd forms 6 ppd quinone. We're doing some ongoing work in our lab to try and understand what the yield of 6 ppd quinone from 6 ppd is, but we certainly haven't closed the mass balance yet. And based on everything we see, 6 ppd quinone always forms from 6 ppd if you contact 6 ppd with an atmosphere. Even ambient air has low concentrations of ozone in it. I think I even saw like Antarctica has like 25 part per trillion. I think that's the right unit for the atmosphere. Whereas like an urban area might have 50 to 100, right? So there's always a little bit of ozone around. Also some of the, you know, we're not sure if 6 ppd reacting with molecular oxygen, you know, might also form the quinone. So that's something we're trying to better understand as well. So there might be some evidence for that as well.
All right, thank you. It looks like this question's for Andrew. It says, did your QTOF analysis reveal any intermediate reaction products in the transformation of 6 ppd to 6 ppd quinone? If so, what chemical formulations did you identify and how do they compare to earlier studies?
You know, there are, just making sure if I can get a nod if my audio is working here, if anyone can hear me. Okay, great. You know, in the mode when we're doing an acquisition for a sample, we're actually in an isolated mode where we don't look at all those other possible masses. But when we were doing method development, we did see a lot of intermediaries that honestly didn't stick around for too long. So the 6 ppd quinone is in our mind sort of the primary pathway. But there are others, and I can't speculate on them. We did work with SciEx, and I know they'd be happy to. They're actually doing a pretty deep dive into that whole pathway. So I'd be happy to put you in touch with them.
All right, thank you for that. It looks like we have James Ritchie. If you could go ahead and unmute yourself and ask your question.
Oh yeah, this is for Andrew. Andrew, thanks for your presentation. Just wanted to know, you mentioned something about being requested to do, you know, your methodology as soon as possible. Are you at liberty to say who made that request?
Yeah, I am the CEO of the company. He takes this very seriously, and he really wanted us to look at it as soon as it came out.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you.
I mean, literally, it's not a joke. Like our motto is testing for life, and that's what we're all about.
All right, thank you for that. So this one looks like it's for USTMA. It says, what chemical was used as an antidegradant before 6 ppd was adopted?
I don't have specifics to offer on the call today, but it's something we can consider and provide more information on in our written comments.
Okay, thank you, Kelly.
Thanks. This question is for Stephanie. Stephanie, I was wondering if any of the fish that are in the stream where there's lots of storm runoff, if they are experiencing, or sorry, I should say any of the coho, are also experiencing reduced oxygen carrying capacity, and what that would mean for their fitness and survival, like long-term survival.
Yeah, that was one of the first questions that I think our partners at NOAA had asked when they saw this phenomenon occur. So they've done a lot of water quality testing, looking at dissolved oxygen, temperature, pH, the presence of other pollutants, and none of those could explain the fish mortalities. They all seemed within normal ranges, and it didn't seem to be a contributing factor in weakening the fish that would, you know, cause them to suffer from exposure to the chemical later. It does seem to be attributed as a unique phenomenon to something else other than what was commonly looked for.
All right. The next question says, looks like it's for Ed. It says, what additional research on 6-PPDQ are he and his team working on and when it might be published?
Yeah, I want to just add something to Stephanie's response there. You know, we talk about urban creeks, and I don't want people to get the impression that this is like a downtown, trash-filled, you know, channelized, ugly creek. Many of the systems where this happens in look great. I mean, they're fully vegetated. The water looks clean. You know, it's just like there's not trash floating around. A lot of these areas have been protected, at least in terms of physical habitat, and like have large woody debris in the water, and there's spawning gravel there. So don't get too much of an impression that these are really degraded habitats. Seattle's also hilly. So these aren't even just like, this isn't like a slow moving, you know, deep algae, low oxygen type system. These are little creeks with rapids, you know, they're well oxygenated. There's a lot of hills near Seattle and in Western Washington, and the creeks reflect that. So just a little clarification, like we call them urban creeks, but most of them are pretty suburban and pretty darn good habitat. You know, this is good West Coast habitat. So I just want to, I feel like sometimes we're a little, the perception on urban creeks is a bit off. In terms of studies my lab is doing, you know, it's always a bit dependent on what funding we have and what the deliverables for those projects are. I can say we're, you know, very interested in understanding what transformation products form when you ozonate or oxygenate 6-PPD. So we're better trying to understand that link between the antioxidant and what we see out in the environment. So those are studies that are ongoing. We are dabbling elsewhere, you know, we're collecting a bunch of data right now on removal and various stormwater treatment systems and just doing comparisons of in versus out to try and see what's removed. We're also continuing to collect data at different portions of the year to understand basically the pollutograph, like, you know, what is base flow have for concentrations? When do they start to elevate in a storm? When do they drop off? We still have a light data set, but for example, some of our spring sampling this year was indicating concentrations near or above the LC50 in spring storms, which implies a risk for juvenile coho salmon that are in those same watersheds. And that was also concurrent with some of these reports I heard of potential juvenile coho mortality coming out of British Columbia, now that people almost started to pay more attention there. So we're very interested in trying to understand, is this just an adults in the fall phenomena, or is this something we also should be concerned about after those eggs hatch and you have juvenile coho in these same watersheds? So we have a number of studies along these lines, but my group is small, so don't expect miracles.
Okay, Topher?
Hi, I'm Topher Buck. I'm a senior environmental scientist here in Safer Consumer Products. And my question is, I guess, for you, Stephanie, and I want to start by saying thank you that, you know, your presentation was great and this is some really fantastic research you're doing. I'm sure that the answer is like, I'm sure you haven't done all this research yet, of course. And so I'm in effect going to ask you to speculate a little bit. I'm just wondering if you have any concerns that 6-PPD or similar chemicals, even if they are less acutely toxic in and of themselves, by opening up the blood-brain barrier and the circulatory system in this way could also enhance the toxicity of other chemicals, right? Because although we're clearly focused on 6-PPD quinone here, as you guys have established very well, these stormwaters are often complex mixtures of anthropogenic chemicals. So anyway, I think you probably get what I'm asking. Thanks.
Yeah, absolutely. I have the same questions, and I don't necessarily have the methodology to be able to test those, although I would love to. I think that would be very exciting research. The first step for me right now, I think, is to look at sublethal and more subtle forms of blood-brain barrier disruption. And so I'm currently developing methods to do that. So that would be step one. And to look at, you know, effects that we're seeing on Chinook and steelhead would be important because we know that they are protected in many areas under the ESA, including in the Puget Sound. I would think that that would be a grave concern because we know that fish are passing through water quality issue, like the Lower Duwamish is a Superfund site. So we know that there's exposure to a lot of contaminants, even for a very short amount of time. So if there is some type of interaction between, you know, sublethal opening of the blood-brain barrier that facilitates those other chemicals getting in and potentially causing problems, I think we need to look at that.
All right, thank you. So the next question actually looks like it's for Andrew. It says, has there been any analysis of 6 PPDQ in the air?
Not yet, but we'd love to. We'd love to partner. We do have other, we're studying PFAS in air, and we've studied PCBs and PAHs and dioxins in air for decades. So, you know, this is on our radar, and just, I guess, hit me up with an email and we can start a talk.
All right, thank you. So it looks like this one's for Stephanie. It says, you talked about runoff causing sublethal effects to zebrafish and herring embryos. What happened to those fish later in the development in the lab? And can you speculate what might happen to them in the wild?
Well, some of the pictures that I, you know, had showed, you can kind of see the malformed jaws. So that fish as an embryo is living basically on absorbing nutrients from its yolk sac. But that fish would not be able to functionally eat or capture prey as it got bigger. So the end result for those fish is ultimately lethal, even though they're still able to survive during those embryonic stages for a period of time. So sublethal doesn't necessarily mean that the fish is going to ultimately survive. In fact, those sublethal effects will end up in mortality.
Okay. Next one says, it looks like this is also for Stephanie. It says, have you evaluated the coho to ensure that they do not have a virus that can make them more sensitive to 6 PPDQ?
I don't think we know enough about the mechanisms involved with 6 PPD to say that there could be an interaction with a virus. I know that what we're seeing are fish out in the wild are being affected, whether they're, you know, wild fish or hatchery fish. It doesn't seem to be necessarily connected with exposure to a particular virus is causing that type of issue.
Next question. It's like it's for Andrew. It says your slide showed loss of half of the 6 PPD in 5 days and a corresponding increase in 6 PPD quinone. Given how reactive 6 PPD is, would you expect to see a higher concentration of 6 PPD quinone in a sample than was actually present when it was collected?
No, not really. The Latimer paper outlines that in biologically active surface waters, the half-life is something like 2 to 3 hours. Even in DI, it's 6 hours. So if we're talking the fact that these samples are collected, they're shipped to us overnight, we have a 7-day hold. Even before that 7-day hold, that reaction is going to be driven all the way to the quinone. So although we're monitoring for 6 PPD in the background, we're really not seeing it. It's really all driven towards the quinone.
Next one looks like it's for USTMA. It says, what info can you share about USTMA's process for understanding toxicity of the transformation products from anti-ozonants like 6 PPD or other chemicals used in tires? If the focus previously has only been on tire particles for which standards are available, will that be expanded during upcoming work?
So as Julie mentioned, 6 PPD and all materials used in tires are REACH registered chemicals. So the chemical manufacturers are required to present information on the transformation products from those materials we're using in tires. We're working to closely coordinate with the 6 PPD manufacturers and learn more about what additional research they have ongoing, which will inform our research plans. We don't want to duplicate work. We want to fill data gaps as expeditiously as possible.
Okay. So it looks like we have time for one more, and then we'll open up for discussion. It says, in your search for sources, have you looked at runoff from granulated tires in synthetic turf fields? Looks like that one's for Andrew.
We haven't collected any of those ourselves. We are prepared to take recycled rubber products, but since they're all client samples, I really can't talk about the concentrations we're finding.
Okay. Go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say, we're ready. If folks want to send us these things, we'll be ready.
Okay. So I'll now pass it off to Dr. Doherty to start some discussion.
Thanks so much, Jessica. And thanks so much to everyone for the really, really great talk that we've seen today. So just wanted a few minutes to kind of have a little bit of discussion. So first I wanted to start off, Becky, I'm going to put you on the spot. We've got Rebecca Sutton from the San Francisco Estuary Institute, who's also joining us. They helped collect some of the data that was, presented in the Tian et al. Paper. So Becky, if you had a minute just to talk, and Andrew and others who had any thoughts on kind of future monitoring that might be occurring in California. And then I'd love to get a few minutes to talk about alternatives.
Sure, I'm happy to bring that up. So the regional monitoring program is now conducting sample collection for year four of our stormwater monitoring effort. So Ed presented, or I guess I presented some findings as well recently on our first year of monitoring, but we have collected samples in subsequent years, and we will be collecting more this coming wet season. Let's hope it's an actual wet season. Now, besides those samples that will be from creeks and storm drains, we are also going to be monitoring San Francisco Bay water, the receiving water itself, to see whether there are detectable levels in that bay water. Some of these samples will be collected right outside of discharge points when storms are actually happening. So we might see higher levels at that point. We will also be collecting samples in our lower South Bay, which is a portion of the bay that has a lot of both wastewater and stormwater influence and not a lot of dilution from the Pacific Ocean. So it tends to be where a lot of our urban contaminants concentrate. And we'll be looking at the lower South Bay, both in the dry season when we might not see so much urban runoff, as well as the wet season.
Great, thank you. I don't know if anyone else, Andrew, you'd probably be the most likely to have any kind of monitoring efforts underway for California. If not, no worries, we can move on.
Was that Andrew or Andrea?
Andrew.
Okay. We don't have any long-term monitoring efforts set up ourselves. Everything we're doing was for our method development. But with that said, we would love to support that work.
Okay,
right now, after hearing some of the material today, our reporting limits at 10 ppt, but we're ready. When UW or whomever publishes that the LC50 may hit 100 ppt, we want to be well below that. So, annoyingly, as a lab guy, there is no such thing as zero, right? We'll just keep going lower.
Thank you. So I'd love to spend a little bit of time talking about alternatives. Of course, that's hopefully the future here to try and help with this problem. And a lot of these issues have been brought up, but just wanted to have a little bit more of a discussion about how we can best advance alternatives to be considered in the alternatives analysis. So as Sarah's talked about, they're going to be undertaking this alternatives analysis process. But to do so, it'd be great if there's multiple options of alternatives that can be considered to try and find one that will work and meet all the safety requirements of the tires. So I'd love if there's any thoughts about how, DTSC or, research as a whole can help advance alternatives, as well as things that need to be considered in evaluating the alternatives. As Sarah said, there's a lot in our process that talks about the different things that, it has to be evaluated in the AA, but there's specific pieces or things that need to be kept in mind. So things that have been brought up include formation of byproducts, of course, making sure it works functionally, but are there other issues that might need to be prioritized and thought about? So any thoughts on that? And Jessica has her hand raised.
Yeah, there's a question for us that's part of the discussion. It just says, what engagement have you had with chemical manufacturers of 6 ppb on this issue? And are you aware of any research by the 6 ppb manufacturers on this issue?
We have been engaged with some of the chemical manufacturers of 6-PPD, but I'm afraid I don't know exactly what research they're planning. Sarah may have an idea or not, but otherwise, that's the extent that I know right now on that piece. All right, Sarah?
I think it's important to bring the chemical manufacturers into the discussion because any alternatives are manufactured by the chemical manufacturers. So having their expertise and understanding about whether any alternatives create transformation products and what their impact could be on the environment, I think they're a really important group with expertise that really needs to be brought into the conversation.
Yeah. And on the research side, you know, are there other pieces, other things that we can do, you know, some sort of a alternatives gathering, you know, next spring or something along those lines that we can help to promote the development of alternatives? Or are there other research that we can help promote on that end? Anyone knows?
I thought Washington Ecology, as part of their budget that was just passed, was doing some research looking at the toxicity of known alternatives to 6-PPD, which are likely in the same chemical family as 6-PPD. So there are other PPD chemistries. I don't know to what extent DTSC is coordinating with Washington Ecology on that research, but that I think is an important piece of information and an important study that's ongoing.
Right. Yeah, we're definitely in touch with them. So. So absent of thoughts on the alternatives, was just wondering about just the research in the future. If I know, Ed, you mentioned you got a small lab, and I know there's a lot of folks doing a lot of really great work. But in terms of, you know, if we had to prioritize what's most important to research, to understand for 6-PPD, quinone, I'd welcome anyone's thoughts on what those might be.
So I think really understanding the mode of action of 6-PPD quinone on the coho salmon is super important because we could identify numerous, I don't know if it's possible, but if numerous alternatives were identified that are functional like 6-PPD, you know, how are we going to know about their toxicity? You know, will we need to do coho salmon testing for every single one? You know, if we had a good understanding of the mode of action, perhaps there could be some QSAR. I think that, you know, that's a really important data gap and really is going to be critical to identifying, you know, a suitable alternative.
Yeah. Ed?
Yeah, I really share that sentiment, you know, just in the process of trying to understand water quality and impacts on coho, it's just been really difficult because we had to use a live fish. You know, we didn't have a cellular assay or anything that was a lot easier. And that meant the volumes of everything need to be bigger. We needed, you know, a lot of mass for exposures. And that just gets pretty tricky analytically. And I'm really hopeful that, you know, we can make a push into mode of action and potentially converting the response into some sort of in vitro or cellular assay. Once we really understand the biochemistry behind this. You know, I also think we need to understand a lot more about the environmental fade. And, you know, that quinones are well known to have toxicity characteristics. You know, some of them are protective antioxidants and kind of good for us, and other ones are, you know, seem to be bad for organisms. So I also think a lot more needs to be done to understand the environmental fade of the quinone and when it's stable, when it's not. We definitely have some systems where it seems really stable, and then we have some systems where we've lost mass and lost concentration without really knowing why. And there's some chemistry back behind that that needs work because it is relevant to the environmental occurrence, the concentrations we're going to see in the environment, where it goes, how we treat it. So we're hoping to push that research forward over time.
Great, thanks. Any other thoughts on that one? I'd also be curious to hear folks' thoughts on, you know, we've heard a little bit about other alternatives, I mean, approaches to either collect tire wear particles or reduce the generation of tire wear particles. And just any thoughts on how helpful that would be in mitigating these impacts and what potential shortcomings could be of those kind of approaches. Sarah?
So I want to point out that the generation of tire and road wear particles really is dependent on a multitude of factors. It's dependent on the vehicle type, the vehicle weight, the type of tire, the topography of the road surface, the type of pavement you're driving on, the driving behavior, if you're an aggressive driver and slamming on your brakes, or if you're a more moderate driver, if you have proper tire inflation. There's a lot of factors that go into generating tire and road wear particles. And I think it's important as we look at this from a holistic standpoint that we include all of those other industries that play a role in the generation of tire and road wear particles. So for example, the auto manufacturers, looking at how we design and construct roads and what materials we're using to pave roads with. Should we look at speed limits in certain areas to reduce tire wear? I think all of those come into play and it requires a multifaceted approach to address.
Thank you. That's really interesting.
Any others? Maybe I might make a comment about Sarah's kind of blending a couple of things. One, I want to let people know that, you know, with respect to what's going on in Washington Ecology, we do have a memorandum of understanding with Washington Ecology and with Oregon DEQ on green chemistry, which is really focused on sharing information, trying to coordinate and collaborate. And it's, I think I can speak for them saying that they're interested in this just as much as we are. They're obviously authorities and regulations and laws are slightly different, but we certainly plan to coordinate and collaborate with them as well as other states and as well as federal agencies. Because as you guys have all pointed out today, there's a lot going on in this space. It's really important that we all understand as much as we can and then operate within our specific authorities and responsibilities. To Sarah's comment on the complexity of the issues, no question. There are a lot of factors that contribute to tire wear particles and all kinds of factors. And I think Ann Cooper showed a slide earlier that shows where our space is in the safer consumer products world. And it's important for everyone to understand that our responsibility and authority has parameters. Yes, we do consider all kinds of inputs and factors and endpoints. And that's really important to make good decisions across the board. But we're not going to be able to holistically solve all these problems. This is going to be a multifaceted approach by many people. But certainly within California, our focus is going to be on our regulations and our responsibilities. And we really believe that this kind of workshop we had today really facilitates everyone's knowledge. And hopefully everyone will then take their roles and responsibilities in the marketplace and in government and move forward.
Thanks, Carl. Well, it actually seems like that you're kind of moving on into some closing comments. I think we're about there. Thanks so much to everyone for your presentations today.
Carl. Okay, well, Ann Cooper, I'll go ahead then, I guess, and close this out. Well, first and foremost, I'd like to thank all of our presenters today for sharing their wisdom and perspectives and the amazing work that everyone is doing on this important issue. I'd also like to thank everyone who participated online and provided questions and perspectives as well. Of course, the workshop today and yesterday wouldn't have happened without the outstanding work and commitment of our staff here at DTSC. We're really blessed to have an outstanding team of scientists, engineers, analysts, and support staff committed to public service and to doing top quality work. So I'm very thankful to all of you. So the dialogue today and yesterday is really critical to our ability to collect and evaluate relevant data and information and to assess our ability to protect California's aquatic resources and environment through implementation of our safer consumer products regulations. But we still benefit from hearing from everyone who didn't speak today. So I'm pleading with all of you who have something to say, send in your comments by going to our website, going to our CalSafer portal and providing us with your input or contacting us directly. And just a reminder that the deadline for your comments to our technical documents on 6PD is September 17th, and the deadline for commenting on our zinc and tires document and our other chemicals of interest document is August 6th. Today's workshop.
Clerk and Carl, sorry, chemicals is September 17th as well.
Oh, I'm sorry. You're right.
Yeah, thank you. Zinc is August 6th. Sure.
Yes. Thank you. After these 2 days of presentations and discussion, we've got a lot of information to evaluate as we decide at DTSC how we best move forward. And you can stay up to date on our process and our decision-making by signing up for our listserv if you haven't already. You can go to our website and check our webpage. And you can also look at what we call our SCP timeline, where we track our major projects, which will include these projects as well as the many other things that we're working on concurrently. And I guess lastly, I'd like to just reflect a little bit on what Director Williams said this morning in her opening. And she noted that I had developed this salmon metaphor for our program. And specifically, I coined a motto that I shared with staff and I wrote on the top of the whiteboard in my office. And it said, be a steelhead, not a salmon. And my main point was that despite facing a lot of challenges and hurdles in our work, we need to take care of ourselves to maintain an ongoing level of performance and not just work really hard for one goal only to die afterwards. So this is a marathon, and I really appreciate everyone who's working on these important issues. We could probably change the motto to be a chum, not a coho, but I don't think anyone would really support that. I do think we could agree that modifying it to protect the steelhead, protect the salmon is something we could agree on. And I'm looking forward to working with all of you towards that goal as we move forward. Thank you again for your participation today and your engagement down the road. And that concludes today's workshop. Thank you.